Well, welcome to the fourth meeting of 2016 of the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee. Before we move to the first item, remind members and those present to switch off mobile phones or at least onto silent. And notice that, of course, community members are consulting tablets during the meeting because they provide the meeting papers in digital format. Agenda item one today is the Land Reform Scotland Bill. We now move to our third day of consideration of amendments to the Land Reform Scotland Bill today. We'll consider amendments picking up where we left off last week and consider amendments up to Part 9 in the Bill. We will have a brief suspension at the conclusion of Part 9 before moving on to Part 10. At that point, we'll be joined by the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Food and Environment and his officials. I welcome back the Minister and her officials, and who will be present for amendments up to Part 9. We'll pause briefly after the first group to allow some changes to the officials supporting the Minister. I note that officials are not permitted to speak on the record in these proceedings. We are joined by Patrick Harvey this morning, who has amendments to lodge. Welcome, Patrick. Everyone should have with them a copy of the bill as introduced, the marshalled list of amendments, which sets out the amendments in order in which we'll be debating them, and in the groupings which were published on Monday. There will be one debate on each group of the amendments. I'll call the member who lodged the first amendment in the group to speak to and move the amendment and to speak to all the other amendments in the group. Members who have not lodged amendments in the group but who wish to speak should indicate to me or the clerk. If the Minister has not already spoken on the group, I will invite her to contribute to the debate just before moving to the winding up speech. I should also note that there may be times when I allow a little more flexibility for members to come back on points during the debate. The debate on each group will be concluded by me inviting the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up. Following the debate in the group, I will check whether the member who moved the first amendment in the group wishes to press it to a vote or to withdraw it. If the member wishes to press ahead, I'll put the question in the amendment. If the member wishes to withdraw their amendment after it's been moved, I'll check whether any other member objects. If any member does object, the amendment is not withdrawn and the committee must immediately move to vote on it. If any member does not wish to move their amendment when it's called, I shall say not moved. Any other MSP present may move such an amendment if and no one moves the amendment. However, I'll immediately call the next amendment on the marshalled list. Only committee members are allowed to vote. Voting on any division is by a show of hands. It's important that members keep their hands clearly raised until the clerks have recorded the vote. The committee is required to indicate formally that it's considered and agreed each section of the bill, so I'll put a question on each section at the appropriate point. If we do not reach the end of Chapter 4 of Part 10 today, then we will stop at an appropriate point and pick up where we left off on Day 4 next week. I hope that's all very clear. So I welcome the Minister, Dr. Eileen MacLeod, and her officials. And we should now move to the first of the amendments. It's a compulsory sale order. And I call Amendment 128, the name of Sarah Boyack, group with Amendment 132, Sarah Boyack, to move the Amendment 132, to move the Amendment 128 and speak to both amendments in the group. Other members, we will see whether we need to come in or not. Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Convener. Well, I would like to move Amendment 128 in my name. I raised the issue in the Stage 1 debate, and at that point, the Minister agreed to pursue the issue in advance of Stage 3, and I wrote to her so that we could exchange ideas about how we might proceed, and I received her reply last week in advance of our committee meeting. This is an issue that has been under consideration and discussion for some time now. Shelter, Scotland's Towns Partnership, the Rural Housing Scotland, and the Scottish Empty Homes Campaign Partnership, and Community Land Scotland, and the Development Trust Association of Scotland have all been very enthusiastic about these measures. It's intended to be used as a last resort where all other approaches to get access to land or properties that have been vacant are brought back into use. And this is something that I think really strengthens the bill, particularly in urban areas, but it could be used in rural areas as well. And it would be seen particularly as a last resort where other mechanisms to bring long-term empty properties and land back into use have failed. It was something we first discussed in the Community Empowerment Bill debates. And the practice is seen as something that would give local authorities another option, another tool in the toolkit to enable them to regenerate communities. They report that current compulsory purchase order legislation is inappropriate for this purpose, and that's why they don't use it. So introducing a compulsory sale order would help local authorities and communities to bring back long-term empty properties and vacant and derelict land that blight communities back into use. It would do this by giving local authorities a legal right to force long-term empty property or derelict land onto the open market for sale with the purpose of securing its reuse. Now, one of the things we talked about when we were gathering evidence for this bill was the number of people, particularly in rural communities, who can't get access to affordable housing. But across the country, we've got 150,000 people waiting on housing waiting lists. And this would be one way that we could begin to increase housing supply levels in a very practical and effective way. The amendment also encompasses the situation of vacant and derelict land, which can blight communities when the land remains in that condition, sometimes for years. So this amendment would not only create an incentive to develop the land, it would also provide an effective sanction when the land is not developed. And I hope that it would concentrate the minds of owners who are sitting on land, waiting till the market rises and waiting for a better price. In the meantime, our communities suffer, our urban environment suffers, and it can blight communities. So this would add an opportunity for local authorities to deal with vacant derelict land and properties, and it would promote better economic and environmental conditions in our communities as well. It would be a cost-effective, viable tool. The current legislation is not and is unlikely to be used by councils. That is the key point. In concluding, convener, I just want to highlight the point that the Development Trust Association Scotland made in submitting their comments. Their view is very strongly that the CSO power would complement measures in the Community Empowerment Act, and like the general right to buy, its greatest impact might be to bring change of culture around the ownership and use of vacant and derelict land. And I believe it would help to encourage discussion and negotiation and hopefully voluntary agreements. Though it's very much seen as a last resort power, but it's a power that doesn't exist at the moment and it is sorely needed. So I move the amendment in my name and look forward particularly to the comments from the Minister. Her letter was very helpful and she welcomed the references to this power at the Stage 1 debate. I know there's been a parallel consultation running along the same time as our discussions on this bill. So in considering whether to push my amendments this morning, I'd be very keen to know where the Minister and the Scottish Government are on the issue, what their plans are, and if the Minister's got a current timescale that she'd be able to mention to the committee or a vehicle by which this measure might be brought to Parliament. Thank you.
Jim Hume.
Thanks very much, Convener. Just to say, I'm supportive of this amendment. I think we can all point to places in urban Scotland, especially where land has just sat there at the same time while some people could, like housing associations, could put up houses and obviously address the housing shortage in Scotland. Obviously, it may even affect local authorities in some respect who do sit on some brownfield sites, etc. So I'm very keen to support Sarah Boyack in her amendment today.
Thank you. Mike Russell.
Yes, I'm very supportive of Sarah Boyack's amendment. It seems to me this has to be done, and both parts of the amendment have to be done. Both the question of the compulsory sale orders, and I think there is a weakness in the present situation, and when you drive around Scotland in both urban and rural areas, you see quite a lot of land which is, if not completely vacant and derelict, is land that could be utilised by communities for the benefit of those communities and by individuals for the benefit of those individuals. Land is a resource. It is a resource that requires to be put to good use, and there are many circumstances that doesn't happen. I also think having, and we'll come to this of course later in group two, but having a register of that land, making it clear what the situation is, will in of itself bring a lot of attention upon the issue. My only reservation is that the parallel consultation has been taking place, and the fact that this is wider than simply a land reform issue. It is an issue that is of great importance to housing. It's an issue of great importance to communities. But I would want to see from the Minister, without any doubt, a commitment to taking this forward across government and an indication of the timescale for it being taken forward. Because I think this is an idea, if I might be not coin a phrase and use a well-worn phrase, it's an idea whose time has come, and it's time that these powers were available to communities in Scotland.
Thank you. Minister, whilst the discussion about the house... Oh, pardon me. I'll come back to Alec Ferguson first, then I'll come in after that.
Sorry, Convener, thank you. Just very, very briefly, I'm also supportive of the principle of this. And I can think of examples in my own constituency of land that's actually owned by an arm of government in the shape of the Forestry Commission, where I think this could be highly applicable. My one concern, and maybe the Minister will come to it, but Sarah Boyack mentioned that she felt that this would complement the Community Empowerment Bill, and I just wonder whether it doesn't actually duplicate the Community Empowerment Bill. But even if it did, I'm not minded to oppose it, but I would just be interested if anybody had any comment to make on that.
Thanks, Alec. Minister, there's a third leg to this stool, the planning review that's taking place at the present time, which, you know, is an independent one. And I wonder whether, in fact, issues about the purchase and compulsory purchase are being taken forward in that area. And I think we would need to know that as well. If you have any information on it, it would help us in our deliberations this morning. Minister?
Thank you, Convener. And can I just start by thanking Sarah Boyack for explaining her Amendment 128 and the related 132. I very much welcome much of what Sarah Boyack and other members have said about this amendment, which seeks to ensure that our local authorities have this power at their disposal and that it could be used as a result of a request from a community group. Now, as we've already heard this morning, in terms of the policy context here, you know, the committee will be aware that the call for the introduction of a compulsory sale order was obviously made in the Land Reform Review Group recommendations that were published in 2014, and those recommendations relating to land assembly, housing and regeneration were the subject of an extensive consultation that was undertaken by the government last summer. And as part of this work, the compulsory sale order recommendation was widely welcomed by over 300 stakeholders that took part in the consultation process. However, I think it was made very clear that a lot more work was required to ensure that power was effective, that there was a correct balance achieved between the rights of owners and benefits that would arise from such a power, and that the fit with existing powers such as the compulsory purchase now were understood. Now, the consultation feedback was, I think, very clear that this power would be most useful for abandoned buildings and small plots of land, particularly those that blight our town centres and neighbourhoods, rather than large pieces of land. I'm happy to confirm my comments that I made during the Stage 1 debate that the Scottish Government are currently considering the issue of compulsory sale orders. Ministers are still giving full consideration to the consultation findings in themselves. And I think to bring forward an effective compulsory sale order, that will take time and very careful consideration. Obviously, in the Stage 1 report on the bill, the committee made it very clear that it is imperative that the bill, as with all legislation that's passed by the Scottish Parliament, is within legislative competence of the Parliament, including being compatible with the ECHR. Now, there are a number of technical, I think, and legal issues with the proposed amendment that help to illustrate, I think, just the type of issues that we would need to consider further before bringing forward effective proposals on this issue. In terms of the particular drafting of this amendment, we would need to consider whether the words, I think, vacant and derelict would need to be defined in this context. Other definitions and key concepts, such as how an order would be enforced, are missing, but there are legal issues that would need to be considered again. A proposal that requires a landowner to sell their land would be an interference with rights under Article 1 of Protocol 1, and that would conclude considering whether such a proposal could pursue a legitimate aim, whether that proposal would achieve that aim, and whether on a fair balance. The benefits of achieving the aim by the proposal outweighs the interference with the Article 1 Protocol 1 rights. But like other members have said, you know, the time has come for our compulsory sale orders. I mean, Scottish ministers intend to fully consider all the issues with any such measure. And obviously, if this government is re-elected, that we would want to bring a CSO forward in the next term of government as part of our ongoing programme of land reform measures. And now, such a measure, because it cuts across a number of portfolios, you know, not just within land reform, but also local government, housing, and as you quite rightly said, convener, on planning. So I can assure the committee and assure Sarah Boyack that we are currently considering this. And obviously, as we've said, you know, it is, you know, the fact that we have an election on the horizon, and as with all plans for potential legislation for the next parliamentary term, it's not possible to give precise timescales as to the overall legislative programme, which is dependent on obviously the outcome of the election. But what I can assure the committee is that the government is absolutely committed to doing this, and we're very happy to keep the committee up to date. And if possible, I would certainly welcome the opportunity to meet with Sarah Boyack along with the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Alex Neil. So given that there is a real commitment there, convener, to take forward work on the compulsory sale orders, I would certainly ask Sarah Boyack to consider withdrawing her amendment in that light.
Thank you. Sarah Boyack, to wind up.
Thank you very much. And can I thank colleagues and the Minister for their comments about this amendment? I will borrow Mike Russell's phrase, it is an idea whose time has come. But it has been hanging around for a while, and that's really why I was keen to push it today. As the Minister said, the Land Reform Review Group raised it. We've discussed it in the Community Empowerment Bill, now Act. It's certainly one of the issues that, when I used to do the local government brief, was something I discussed with local government colleagues in relation to town centre improvements and regeneration. So the idea has been around for quite a while now, and I was very keen to make sure that we came back to this on the record so that we could secure a commitment from the Minister. I was hoping maybe for before stage three of this bill, but I am an optimist. So I have hopefully secured the commitment right around the table across the parties for this. And I think it's something that we could all work together on. Getting the detail right, I would have been astonished if my amendment had been perfect in all respects. But I'll take the general political support that there has been around the table today. I think the campaigners out with the Parliament, some of whom are here today, will hopefully be reassured by what we can now all take as a commitment from all of us to pursue this. Over the next few weeks and months, and certainly into the next Parliament, it would be an additional power, it would be an additional option for local authorities. And the points that were made by colleagues about what's going to be in the register, the different types of land that might be available in urban and rural communities, I think it would complement the powers in this bill and the Community Empowerment Act, and would help us tackle both the problem of lack of affordable housing, but also our town centres. And for those reasons, I'll not push it today, but I'm grateful to everybody for their positive comments. Thank you.
So Sarah Boyack's wishing to withdraw Amendment 128 with the agreement of the committee. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? No member objects, so the amendment is therefore withdrawn. Change of officials, I think, at the moment. The next amendment concerns non-domestic rates, vacant and derelict and unoccupied industrial lands and heritages. Call Amendment 129, the name of Patrick Harvey, group with Amendments 130, 131 and 133. Patrick Harvey to move Amendment 129 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thanks very much, and good morning, Convener. As a non-member of the committee, I didn't ask to speak in the last group, but I would want to endorse many of the arguments that were put by members about the issue, which is certainly one that I can recognise in Glasgow as well. This group of amendments are related. They seek to address some of the same concerns, albeit in a different way. And as Sarah Boyack described her proposal as perhaps something that would be used as a last resort, this proposal is one which might be something more of a first incentive in relation to the same issue of vacant and derelict land and buildings. When I come to the committee to move amendments, I always do so in a spirit of hopefulness. In this instance, I'd like to think that there's some cause for that, given that some of what this group of amendments is trying to do is very much in keeping with aspects of the government's own agenda. I'd like to mention Amendment 131 first of all, because in relation to unoccupied industrial land and buildings, this is something which the Scottish Government has already taken some action on or indicated an intention to act on. The Local Government Finance Settlement makes it clear that the Government proposes to reform reliefs of empty property for industrial property, effectively bringing them into the same treatment as empty retail property. And the Federation of Small Businesses welcomed this, noting the intention that there would be an incentive to, by reducing the amount of property relief, landlords would have an incentive to drop rents, invest in their properties, making them more attractive to potential tenants. I very much welcome the steps that the Scottish Government has taken in that line, and this amendment simply locks that in for the future. Obviously, all governments hope that they'll be in power for all time, but that's not necessarily the case. I would hope that the government is willing to support Amendment 131 and ensure that its own policy is given a statutory basis and a clear signal that it's going to be a long-term provision. Amendment 133 is consequential to that. Amendment 129 takes the same principle and extends it to vacant and derelict land and the many instances that were discussed, I think, in relation to the last group of amendments. Again, we can all recognise the reality that in our constituencies and regions there are many examples of land which could be put to better use. Bringing this land back into the valuation role, making sure that the owners of it have some financial incentive to put it to use, to invest in it, or indeed to dispose of it at a fair price if they don't wish to put it to use themselves. I think this would be an important step to eradicating some of the perverse incentives which exist. For example, there are situations in which owners of land have an incentive to demolish buildings which exist on it in order for it effectively to cease to show up on the valuation roll. As far as I understand it, there's not an explicit exemption for this land. It's more a question of ongoing case law over centuries, and I think we've arrived at a situation which we would not have done by design. So this amendment and 130, which is consequential to it, is intended to rectify that situation. I'm told by the legislation team that there might be some requirement for modification to other aspects of the bill as a result of that, but my understanding is that the bill already gives ministers a general power, so I've not included that as a specific aspect of these amendments, given that the general power exists within the bill. And I move Amendment 129.
Thank you. Are there any other members who wish to speak? Mike Russell.
I'm also, as I said earlier, sympathetic to the idea of the register of the incentives, and I think there's something inherently attractive in both having a last resort power and an early incentive for people to consider what should happen. I think the amendments that Patrick Harvey is moving are more applicable to the urban situation and to my own constituency, but I do think they could have applications within my own constituency, and there are places where there is a blight on community activity and development because of the way in which land and buildings are treated. So I'm sympathetic to these. I have a feeling that some of the reservations that the Minister put forward in terms of the progress that she is making and the need to have that progress more widely across government may apply here too. but I don't think there would be any lack of willingness to accept that the principles that Patrick Harvey are enunciating are principles that we should be able to take on board. The practicality of putting them into place is always the difficulty, but the idea is the right idea.
Alec Ferguson.
Yeah, just very briefly, Convener, thank you. I can see where Patrick Harvey's coming from with these amendments, but I see great practical difficulties, and I see enormous potential for conflict and argument when it comes to determining if land is really derelict or whether it is actually serving a purpose environmentally, for instance, in not being used for what one might deem to be normal traditional use. And I'm not minded to support them at this stage. I can see the principle behind it, but I think there are practical difficulties in implementing these if it were to be passed. Thank you.
Any other members? No. Minister, do you want to respond?
Thank you, Convener. And can I just thank Patrick Harvey for bringing forward these amendments. We're setting out the rationale behind this group of amendments and, you know, absolutely understand the principles behind them. And now, obviously, the intention with Amendment 129 to include the vacant and derelict property on the valuation roll, that is already provided for in statute. I mean, non-domestic property is currently entered in the valuation roll, whether vacant or derelict or not, and that's subject to specific exclusions such as farms and shooting snows. So this amendment also seems to intend the prescription of the valuation method for vacant and derelict property. So, but the provision is flawed because it refers to a method that is prescribed by Section 6(1) of the Local Government Scotland Act 1975, but that is only an order-making power and itself does not prescribe any valuation methods. This part of the amendment also refers to, and I quote, Convener, such method as the assessor considers appropriate. So that would seem to be the opposite effect of prescription, which is to curtail the discretion that the assessor otherwise has in respect of valuation. So for these reasons, I think Amendment 129, I think, seems to be flawed both in its intention and in its content. So for that reason, Convener, I would ask Patrick Harvey to withdraw this amendment. Amendment 130 obviously is consequential on Amendment 129, and I would ask Patrick Harvey not to move this amendment. In terms of Amendment 131, can I just assure Patrick Harvey that, I mean, the government wishes to retain different rates relief provisions for empty industrial property and for other empty non-domestic property. Now, we've, as Patrick Harvey has said, we have made related proposals as part of the draft budget 2016-17 to limit the rate-free period for empty industrial property to the first 3 months that the property is empty and to provide 10% relief thereafter, and for non-industrial property to reduce relief for the initial three-month period from the current 100% to 50% and to retain the current 10% relief thereafter. Now, in our view, these changes can be made by, I think, secondary legislation and subject to final ministerial decisions, and we will be laying regulations soon. So I would ask Patrick Harvey not to move this amendment. And obviously, in terms of Amendment 133, which is consequential on Amendment 129, would ask Patrick Harvey not to move this amendment. But I would also like to add to that that I'd certainly be very happy to explore with both the assessors and with Patrick Harvey the practical approach and the outcomes around us.
Okay. Patrick Harvey to wind up and press or withdraw.
Thank you, Convener. Well, I'm grateful for those who've recognised the case in favour of this. We've not only got to try and recognise the incentives or increase the incentives to bring derelict and disused land and buildings back into use, but we should also recognise that this is a potential source of revenue. You know, the current estimates of the amount of derelict and disused land and buildings suggest to us that a reasonable rate poundage of the existing rate poundage of 48p, we'd be able to generate over £300 million per annum from the existing derelict and disused land and buildings in Scotland. If we talk about the need for investment in social housing, it's not just a case of freeing up the land, it's also a case of finding the revenue that we want to invest. This proposal would do something toward both of those objectives, the land and the money that would need to be spent in order to achieve what is, I think, a shared objective. So I recognise the comments the Minister has made about the technical aspects of these amendments. I wasn't quite clear whether the Minister was endorsing the intention, the basic proposition that this is a thing that should be done. Is she saying that this is the wrong way to do something which ought to happen, or that this ought not to happen? I'd be interested if she can be a little clearer, if she's permitted to intervene.
Minister, do you want to respond?
Just to say that the current legislation, I think, on this is very quite clear around that.
Thank you.
The only point I would...
Patrick Harvey?
Well, I'm tempted, convener, to ask permission to withdraw Amendment 129 on the understanding that I would have some discussion with the Minister prior to the deadline for Stage 3 amendments and might come back with a revised version of this, if that's agreeable.
OK, Patrick Harvey is asked to withdraw Amendment 129. And does this have with the agreement of the committee? Does any other member object to the amendment being withdrawn? No other member objects to the amendment being withdrawn. Thank you, Patrick. Non-domestic rates, shootings and deer forests. We call Amendment 94 in the name of Alec Ferguson, group with Amendments 122, 123, 124, 125, 126, 95 and 99. Alec Ferguson to move Amendment 94 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, convener. Amendments 94 and 95 seek quite simply to remove sections 66 and 67 from the bill, the result of which would be to continue the exclusion from the valuation roll of shootings in deer forests for the time being. During our evidence taking, particularly at the meeting in Dumfries, it became increasingly obvious that the government was frankly unclear about too many aspects of this part of the bill. The Minister, with respect, was unable to answer questions about how much the measure was likely to raise, how much it would cost to raise it, how much it was required to raise, given the First Minister's earlier statements that proceeds would go towards the Scottish Land Fund, or even how the assessors would go about the exercise of assigning a rateable value to every acre of non-urban land in Scotland, and I'll come back to that in a minute, if I may. The government was not even able to answer the question of why shootings in deer forests had been singled out, while several other forms of non-agricultural land use will continue to be exempted. The result of our Stage 1 deliberations was as damning a section of a Stage 1 report as there's likely to be in this parliamentary session. The committee was unconvinced by the government's arguments and suggested strongly that a major rethink was required. Now, not the least of our concerns was the lack of any social, economic or environmental impact assessments. But I have to say the aspect that concerns me almost most of all is that in answer to the question of why the government seeks to reintroduce this tax, the only answer has been that it is a question of fairness. And I have to ask exactly to whom this fairness applies. If I could refer members to the letter to the committee from the Minister and the Cabinet Secretary for Financial Sustainable Growth that was sent on the 19th of January. Paragraph 72 of that letter refers to the Minister's view that the 8,000 subjects that were on the valuation roll in 1995 is an indication of the scale of the exercise that is faced in this instance. But in their evidence, the Scottish Assessors Association told us that the total potential entries was likely to be between 52 and 55,000. So I wonder if the Minister could explain why she appears to be seeking to include only a small proportion of the subjects, and who is going to decide as to which subjects go onto the roll and which don't. Paragraph 73 of that same letter states that the Minister notes, and I quote, "The suggestion from some stakeholders that shooting entries will be required in the valuation rolls in respect of every acre of land. This, however, was not the case for the many years that shootings were rateable, and this bill proposes no such change or anything to cause such a change." End of quote. So I have to ask also, does this mean that the government is advocating that many of those who should be on the roll, valuation roll, are not actually going to end up on it, because that's what happened last time? Many people, prior to the exemption coming in, many people appealed their rates bill successfully, with the result that some people ended up carrying the tax burden, while others carried on happily, rates-free, thanks to what was effectively government-approved avoidance measures. Now, these two approaches don't seem to me to exemplify the principle of fairness that the Scottish Government says that it seeks. Indeed, the only witness that we met in our travels as a committee who is dependent on running a shooting business was an individual who rents the shooting from a Borders estate. That business employs seven people in a rural area and many more during the shooting season itself, to say nothing of those who come to shoot, staying in local hotels, adding considerably to the local economy. Now, that individual explained to us that while he makes a living from his business, the profit margins are not huge, and that the weather plays a major part in whether the business actually shows a profit or not. I suspect this year he might have some difficulty. But that business is situated only a few miles from the border, and I do find myself asking how it can possibly be fair to that witness, or to the seven employees of his business, or to the local hotels and shops that benefit from it, to impose a burden of taxation on it that will not have to be borne by a similar business just south of the border. Sporting rates will simply place that businessman at a massive competitive disadvantage with similar business just a few miles away. I don't think that's fair, Convener. In fact, I think it's the absolute opposite. It's often been said that the exemption was first introduced by a Tory government as a sop to its benefactors, and that is absolute nonsense. The exemption was brought in because the cost of collecting the rates was overtaking the amount that was actually being raised. And thus far, the government has not been able to tell us how much it's likely to cost to implement and raise the sporting rates that it seeks to impose. I wonder if I could remind members also of our statement in our Stage 1 report, referring to the ending of the exemption, when we said, based on the available information, the committee believes that the case has not yet been made. Now, the committee asked for robust and comprehensive evidence-based analysis of the potential economic, social, and most importantly, I think, the environmental impacts of this proposal. And I don't believe that the limited amount of information that has been provided since comes anywhere close to satisfying that request. And just to conclude, Convener, if I could say just a brief word about the possible environmental impact that this might have, because I think that is important. Shooting businesses are known to assist in the delivery of the Scottish biodiversity strategy, and it is an interesting fact that shoots over farmland are proven to help in providing habitat that actually reverse the trend of the decline in farmland songbird numbers. I think it is worth noting that the Game and Wildlife Conservation Trust support these amendments on the ground that without the evidence-based assessment that this committee has asked for, this part of the bill poses an unqualified risk to the environment, is based on unclear policy drivers, and displays a failure to acknowledge the conservation benefits that stem from game management. I have to say I agree fully with that, Convener. So until the requests of the committee are fully complied with in respect of this part of the bill, I believe that it should be removed from it. That's the purpose of the amendments in my name, Convener, and I move Amendment 94.
Thank you. Mike Russell. Sorry, I beg your pardon, Mike. I'm sorry, the Minister has to speak to Amendment 122 first before we bring in other members. And then Mike has to speak to your Amendment 126. Sorry.
Is it not Amendments 94, Convener?
Sorry, I'll be, you speak to all the amendments in the group. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry. I'm just wakening up again. Sorry, it wasn't what you said, Alec. It was just... Minister,
you're just giving me
your amendments and all the amendments in the group. Yeah.
Thank you, Convener, and... thank you to Mr. Ferguson for explaining his amendments 94 and 95, which would together remove the Part 6 provision to return shootings and deer forests to the valuation role. Now, I would reiterate the purpose of Part 6. It is to enable revenue raising to fund public services and to reflect fairness, returning shootings and deer forests to the same rating regime that applies to the majority of other non-domestic properties. Now, to briefly recall the background to the current exemption, dating from 1995, the rationale given by UK ministers at the time was to align Scotland's arrangements with those in England. But their exemption did not do that. The alignment was only achieved when a subsequent exemption was legislated for in England, taking effect in 1997. Now, others have suggested that the reason for the 1995 exemption was that the administrative cost exceeded the revenue, but there is no evidence to support that. Now, we have engaged local government and the assessors on the administrative costs and consider them to be incremental and sustainable. Now, I recognise the issues with scrutinising a valuation provision such as this, as it is not a rating provision and does not in itself determine rates revenue. So for non-domestic rates, the first step is valuing the tax base. And given the absence of entries in the valuation roll since 1995, there is no available data source to identify shootings and quantify rents. Now, as with the 220,000 properties already on the valuation roll, this work is for the assessors. Now, in light of this, the government has committed, subject to the passage of the bill, to return to the committee to provide information on the emerging valuations once they are available, and to invite the committee to express any views before rating decisions are made ahead of implementation next year. Now, at this stage, 2017 rates revenue cannot be predicted accurately for any sector, as we know neither the valuations, the poundage, nor the relief eligibility for respective properties, and that is the case across all the sectors ahead of a revaluation year. Now, we have also said, Convener, that if re-elected, that we will continue the small business bonus scheme for the duration of the next Parliament. And I anticipate many shootings being eligible for considerable rates relief under that scheme, which already benefits around 100,000 rateable properties, and the liability should be considered in that context. Now, having considered the extensive evidence on this proposal, including our own public consultation, which drew over 1,000 responses with 71% agreement from those who gave a view, now, we do consider that this measure is sustainable, as it was for over 100 years before the exemption. Now, we recognise the potential conflict with our, you know, our wider deer management policies, and you know, taxes can conflict with objectives for any sectors, and this doesn't necessarily mean that we should not tax, but our intention is for a fair and a sustainable rating liability, and our view is that any such conflicts are manageable. Now, the assessors will work with the sector to ensure that there is an appropriate valuation methodology, and I welcome the preliminary discussions that are already underway. And as with all rating valuation, you know, ratepayers can appeal their valuations in independent hearings. Now, we have presented the available evidence to the committee, and despite calls for more information and more analysis, we've received, you know, no suggestions as to what the alternative data sources or types of analysis might be. The government has also not heard any compelling evidence why shootings in deer forests should remain a special case and be entirely excluded from valuation and rating, and accordingly does not agree that the current exemption should continue. So the government, you know, we intend to continue to work closely with our stakeholders during the scrutiny of the bill and then ahead of and during implementation to secure fair and workable arrangements. So I would ask Alex Ferguson to withdraw amendments 94 and 95. I just want to also add, Convener, I know there were some comments that Mr. Ferguson had made in his opening remarks about the comments are made by the Chair of the Scottish Assessors Association, Alistair McTaggart, when we're talking about whether there should be shooting entries in the valuation rolls covering every single area of land. Now, there were, as we've said in our analysis, there were around 8,000 shootings on the roll in 1994. By comparison, there are around 55,000 farms, as well as other land holdings in terms of estates and woodlands. But when the Chair of the Scottish Assessors Association was before the committee on the 30th of September, Alistair McTaggart, which I think may have caused some confusion, he did say, hypothetically, every shooting right should be in the valuation role. But however, over the 100 years leading up to 1995, a degree of pragmatism came in, and the valuable shootings, the shootings for which the right was exercised and for which there was some value in that right, were the ones that were entered in the valuation role. And assessors will now have to re-establish the position in the next 2 to 3 years.
Thank you. Mike Russell to speak to Amendment 126 and the others in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I was a little alarmed last week to get an email from a... Mike. I will eventually get to say it.
You will eventually.
You just don't want this amendment.
The Minister wants to see some more about
indeed,
other amendments
in the group. Indeed,
finish
on the rest of the amendments in the group.
Sorry, I thought you had...
In terms of Amendment 99, I do thank again Alex Ferguson for explaining his Amendment 99. Obviously, Amendment 99 is consequential on Amendments 94 and 95, which I've asked Mr Ferguson to withdraw. So I'd also ask Mr Ferguson to withdraw Amendment 99. In terms of our own amendments, Convener, Amendments 122 to 125, they amend the wording of Section 67 to remove any unintended scope for misinterpretation. Amendment 122 simply removes the term yearly value, which, although used right up until 1995, has now been questioned by some stakeholders, given that the prescribed form in existing subordinate legislation, that's the Valuation Role and Valuation Notice Scotland Order 1989, is for entries in the Valuation Role to include net annual value and rateable value. Now, given this existing provision, this amendment removes any possible doubt as to what is required. Amendment 123 inserts the term relating to make the link with the valuation area, so that shootings are entered in a valuation role only so far as they relate to that valuation area. Amendment 124 inserts the term insofar as situated in, to make the link with the valuation area, so that deer forests are entered in a valuation role only so far as they are situated in that valuation area. And Amendment 125 removes the original links to the valuation area, insofar as exercisable or, as the case may be, situated in, for shootings and deer forests respectively, which are instead addressed by Amendments 123 and 124. So the combined purpose, Convener, of these three amendments, 123, 124 and 125, is to remove the term exercisable and correspondingly just avoid any doubt as to its interpretation. So the intention of the original wording was just simply to make the link to the valuation area, not to invite a distinction to be made as to whether shootings were exercisable or not. The amended wording removes any possible doubt in this respect, and I would remove my amendment 122.
Thank you, Minister. And now, with bated breath, Michael Russell to speak to Amendment 126 and others in the group.
Absolutely sure. Good. I was alarmed on Friday to receive an email from a local journalist in Argyll who said that she understood that Alec Ferguson and I were jointly moving amendments to wreck this part of the bill. I was a little concerned about this and asked where this came from, and apparently the Countryside Alliance had made this assertion either on its website. So I'd just like to make it clear that that is not the intention of this amendment. I do not share Alec Ferguson's view that the government has failed to come forward with more information. I think it has come forward with more information. I think that information is perfectly easy to understand, and I think it is quite clear why this section is within the bill, and I shall be supporting this section. However, we should not rewrite history. I was interested enough in the issue of the abolition of sporting rates to go back and look at the reasons why that had happened. And amongst those reasons, and I'm quoting from the Minister of the Day, was the wish that the money spent on sporting rates, and I use the quote, should go to better management of deer. And there was an attention, I shall say something later on, Convener, about the history of deer management in Scotland, which is not a terribly happy one in the last 60 years. But there was an intention that the resources of estates should be used for the better management of deer. And all I'm seeking in this amendment is to continue that linkage, to make sure that if sporting rates are in existence, they do not impact in a detrimental way on deer management. I contend and will contend later on that the situation we are in terms of deer management is considerably worse than it was in 1995. And to that extent, I don't think the proprietors involved did use those resources for the better management of deer. So there is in itself an argument for reimposing these sporting rates. But I do not wish to see these that imposition undertaken in circumstances where they might even accidentally produce circumstances in which deer management suffers. So I am looking at the very least to the Minister for an assurance that this will be an issue that will be borne in mind and that will form part of the general guidance to the assessors. And I hope assessors considering this matter, and the Minister has referred to custom and practice by assessors, that assessors will consider this debate and the debates that this committee has had and read those debates and realise that deer management is of extreme importance in Scotland and needs actually more activity and more resource and not less activity and less resource. So I look forward to that reassurance of the Minister to see whether or not I will actually move the amendment.
Jim Hume.
Thank you very much, Convener. Still waiting on my microphone.
Never mind. Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. I'd be minded to support Alex Ferguson with some of his amendments. The Minister has mentioned that in 1995 there's no evidence that the revenue received covered the costs of gathering that income. I think there's also no evidence that incomes received would exceed gathering that income, because we have not had enough evidence back from the government, especially regarding the economic, environmental and social impact. I represent, like many other people, very remote areas where there's very little options for employment, and I feel that bringing in the domestic, non-domestic rates for shootings and deer forest shootings especially could actually see a loss of jobs in some of the more remote areas. I believe it's more of a political move. I believe it's more pointed at the so-called landed gentry. But we have to remember that there's tenancies and very ordinary working folk that actually engage in shooting. So I think that those would be the people that would be more at risk. There was an independent survey work done back in 1999-2000 in the Scottish Borders where they looked at the economic impact of shootings and the like for that very specific area. It pointed out that there was £41 million brought into the economy. Lots of hotels would not be open during the winter periods if there was not shootings active in the area. Therefore, I'd be happy to support Alex Ferguson with his amendments.
Graham Day.
Thank you, Convener. Alex Ferguson is right to say that in our Stage 1 report, the committee raised significant concerns over the issue of sporting rates relief on the basis that we had insufficient information. But I think unlike Mr Hume and Mr Ferguson, I am reassured by the government's response, both in writing and again today, so I'm not going to support Mr Ferguson's amendments. I do, however, have some considerable sympathy for the sentiments and the intent which lie behind Mr Russell's amendments, though I suspect this matter might perhaps be more appropriately addressed in guidance if the government's minded to offer encouragement to estates and shoots to continue doing the right things or begin to do the right things in terms of deer management. But can I ask the Minister to comment on a particular aspect of this matter? As we've heard, those who oppose the measure warn, amongst other things, that it has the potential to harm local economies and therefore undermine local communities. I just wonder whether the reverse potentially could very much be the case. The sums generated to be generated here are earmarked for the land fund, which would support acquisitions. And I think I'm right in saying that can include helping meet the cost of the formulation of business plans. Can I ask whether there is or could be scope to go beyond that and fund, say, Community Land Scotland to proactively seek to develop capacity in communities where there is an interest in acquisitions but a lack of knowledge of how to go about such? And as part of that, they would be charged with raising awareness of the fact such support could be available to communities of length and breadth of Scotland, because I'm not convinced at the moment that everyone who might be interested in getting involved in this sort of thing fully understands the backup that might be there for them.
Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. The Stage 1 report from the committee did indeed say that on the available evidence the case had not been made, but I think it's a case that I'm reassured by today, as with my colleague Graham Day, and I think it's important that this type of non-domestic rate returns to the same arrangements as the majority of non-domestic property rates. I note what the Minister says about it being incremental and sustainable, and I was reassured by the Minister's comments about the assessors and the development of Scottish Government dialogue with them, and also that in the next Parliament that there will be a return to the committee seeking views on the arrangements, which I think will be very important because there will need to be analysis at that stage. It is very important that small businesses are protected, and I've listened to what the Minister said about that. Finally, I would want to support Mike Russell's Amendment 126, and I think it is important that there is a continuation of a linkage of rates, or at least that there is a linkage between the monies raised and future deer management, however that might be. And I'm listening to what Graham Day's suggestion was on that. But
members? Oh, yes, Sarah Boyack.
Yep, just a brief addition to the comments of Claudia Beamish. I think one of the things that's quite striking when you think about the in-principle policy position here is why to continue to exempt shootings when there are quite a lot of other rural businesses that are also marginal, that struggle depending on climate, and that are also related to wildlife and tourism. So it does raise quite a lot of wider issues about what is appropriate. And I think the discussions we wanted at our Stage 1 committee was that wider consideration of what the impact was and a commitment to monitoring. And I think we've pretty much got that. But in principle, I think the other elements in this bill about deer management need to be considered at the same time, and we need a joined-up discussion about this. And I think the reintroduction of these business rates needs to be monitored. But in principle, I don't see why shooting should be excluded when other rural businesses like wildlife or tourism businesses, which are also involved in management issues, are included in the rate system. So I think there's a fairness issue here. Thank you.
Minister, I wonder if you've given consideration to equal opportunities issues in relation to the seasonal workers who are employed for shootings and so on. Do we have any information in terms of them being paid the minimum wage or indeed a living wage in terms of the businesses which have been discussed that people have had concerns about? I don't know whether you have information about that, but I just thought it was worth asking the question. Minister, to respond.
Yes, a good point, Convener. I don't obviously have that level of detail with me this morning to hand, but I'm more than happy to supply that to the committee in writing.
Would you like to respond now?
Yeah, can I thank the members for the contribution to this, the amendments around 126 from Michael Russell and also the other amendments in the group. Can I thank Michael Russell for, I think, setting out the rationale behind his amendment 126. As we know, amendment 126 would give the assessors discretion to set the rateable value of shootings and deer forests lower than the net annual value to reflect good management in the public interest. So I very much understand the intention of this amendment and the reasons behind it. However, such discretion would be problematic as it would require the assessor themselves to interpret whether good management existed and, subject to that, to apply a deduction at their own discretion, which could range from zero up to the full net annual value. That is, they could set the rateable value at zero. So I think, excuse me, convener, I think such a judgment and the corresponding revenue effects might sit beyond the long-standing role of the assessor in valuing property. So more tangible criteria, I think, would normally be provided for in such derating under the Valuation Acts. Now, I note the discretion that the assessors would have under the unamended provision. For example, before the current exemption was put in place in 1995, assessors discounted valuations to take account of increased culling activity due to government policies. Now, although the assessors cannot give a guarantee at this time of what their future methodology would be, they have confirmed that valuation would take account of all material factors. Now, can I give a reassurance to Mr. Russell that the government, you know, we acknowledge and we recognise that we need to get there through a whole combination of regulation and incentives. And my officials and myself have given the issue of a relief much thought and consideration. I think if it appears that the business rates are unduly interfering, you know, with that goal, then we will consider whether it is necessary to provide relief through the normal mechanism of rating reliefs or an alternative support measure ahead of the rating implementation in April 2017. So it certainly will be borne in mind when we're working with the assessors. I want to give that assurance to Mr. Russell and other members of the committee. But I think the tax base for shootings in deer forests, you know, that will be a more permanent reference point in primary legislation. It should be valued under the same general provision as other non-domestic properties, with the same due discretion for the assessors to reflect relevant factors. So, as I said, Part 6 is a valuation measure. It's not a rating one. So this is the necessary first step to value the tax base before we consider rates, reliefs and revenues. And I think only once that step is complete can an informed assessment be made of a new relief. So it's just to give that assurance to the committee and also say to Mr. Russell. And in that light, I would propose, or I would ask Mr. Russell not to move this amendment, but to give a clear commitment to engage the sector once we have seen the emerging valuations, probably later this year and ahead of making rating decisions in 2017. In terms of the points that were raised by Mr. Graham Day, I think what I would say to Graham Day is that the First Minister had said in our programme for government's speech to Parliament on the 26th of November 2014, that ending the rates exemption would obviously help the government increase the Scottish Land Fund. So we certainly absolutely will welcome and will consider any expenditure proposals that are linked to the non-domestic rate income from shootings and deer forests.
Thank you, Minister. Alec Ferguson to wind up and press or withdraw his amendment.
Thank you, Convener. I won't take up a great deal of the committee's time. Just for a point of clarification, in regards to the information that the committee had asked the government to come forward with before stage two, I did not say that it had not brought forward any further information. I said that, in my opinion, the information it had brought forward didn't come close to satisfying the committee's request. I still believe that to be the case, bless you. I'm not happy with where we're at in that regard. I'm somewhat confused by the Minister's response to my amendments because she has acknowledged there is no available data, that accurate assessments of future revenue cannot be made, and yet believes that the measure is sustainable as in the way it's been tabled. I find it very difficult. She says it will raise revenue and be fair. Past experience, frankly, would suggest that it will be neither. I'm very supportive of Mike Russell's amendment, and I'll be sorry if he withdraws it. Rates can be a considerable burden, but in this case, I believe they could be used as a great incentive to encourage proper deer management. This committee has been very hard on deer managers and deer management organisations, and I think that this the Mike Russell's amendment, which I was about to table something very similar myself when I realised that Mr. Russell had already tabled it, I think provided that incentive. I find it worrying that there might be a situation whereby an estate is carrying out exemplary deer management in the way that we would all want to see happen, and yet is then hit by a rates burden for doing so. I will be sorry if Mr. Russell withdraws that amendment, but although I do hear what the Minister says in regards of taking it forward. I'm going to press my amendment, Convener, and in doing so, I'm very mindful of a little bit of verbal evidence that we got off the record when we were in the Borders, when a tenant farmer told us, he said, just be careful when you're going after the big guys that you don't catch out the wee guys. The people who will be badly impacted by this are not the owners of shooting rights or those who, well, it may be those who run shooting businesses, but it will be the wee guys, the beaters, the hoteliers and others who are very dependent on this thing, on this activity. And with that, Convener, I will press Amendment 94.
Okay. The question is that Amendment 94 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. Raise your hands for those who are for. One, two. Thank you. Those who are against, raise your hands. And no abstentions. So there were two for and seven against. Therefore, the motion is not carried. And we now put the question on section 66 and go straight to amendment. Do we agree to put the question on section 66?
Does the committee agree to section 66?
Sorry, does the committee agree to question to section 66? Right, otherwise, okay, then we don't agree to section 66, in which case...
Sorry, can I?
Yeah. Well, in fact, section 66 has been that the amendment 94 was intent on removing section 66. We have already agreed not to do so, so therefore we will go straight to amendment 130.
Section 66 has been agreed.
Section 66 has been agreed to. Yep. Not at all. Amendment 130, call 130 in the name of Patrick Harvey, already debated with 129. Patrick Harvey to move or not move?
Not
moved. Thank you. In that case, we will move on to the question as amendments. Call amendments 122, 123, 124 and 125, all in the name of the Minister, all previously debated. Invite the Minister to move amendments 122 to 125 on block.
Moved on block.
Thank you. Any member object to a single question being put? No. If any member, nobody does. So the question is that amendments 122 to 125 are agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Call amendment 126, the name of Michael Russell, already debated with amendment 94. Mike Russell to move or not move?
I do accept the Minister's assurance, but I would reserve the right to bring something back at stage three, which puts on the face of the bill the issue of good deer management in this area. So I would like to have those discussions with the Minister, because I do think there is a need to put into the bill a reference to good deer management within this section. So I won't move it at the moment, but I will take the opportunity to come back.
Thank you. Mike Russell has not moved. Member want to move it?
Well, I wonder if I could seek an assurance from the Minister, Convener, that she will have that discussion with Mr. Russell, because if she's not, I would imagine the answer to that is probably yes, because she knows what's good for her.
Oh dear!
But if she could give that assurance, then I won't move this amendment, as I'm very tempted to do.
Convener, okay. Absolutely, I'm happy to give that assurance that I will meet with Mr. Russell to discuss his amendment.
Thank you very much. So, Mike Russell has not moved that. Call Amendment 95 in the name of Alec Ferguson, already debated with Amendment 94. Alec Ferguson to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. Amendment... here, we call Amendment 131 in the name of Patrick Harvey, already debated with Amendment 129. Patrick Harvey to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you very much. And now the question is that Amendment 132. So, question is that Section 68 and 69 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you for attending. That's the end of
this particular involvement by Patrick Harvey. Now we move on to deer management. We call Amendment 119 in the name of Claudia Beamish, group with Amendments 1, 2, 120, 121, 3 and 4. Claudia Beamish to move Amendment 119 and speak to all the amendments in the group. Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. Scotland is probably unique in having a public resource such as deer, which are largely managed as if they were private property. Other bodies, mainly public, typically pick up the costs for this arrangement, damage to forestry, deer fencing, road accidents, and effects on biodiversity and wider environmental impacts. In Scotland, the voluntary approach to deer management has given been given every opportunity to work, and the 2014 Deer Management Group assessment, published only in October 2015, shows quite a poor delivery in many areas against public interest outcomes, which was of concern to the committee. The amendments which I propose are not costly or particularly complex, although it is a very complex issue to resolve and has been an issue that has been ongoing in Scotland for many years. When the committee took evidence on deer management and its impacts on the natural heritage, that was in 2013 when I was on this committee, and there was a concern at that point, which the minister, the then minister, Paul Wheelhouse, actually clarified, summed up for me by stating, "I too recognise that deer populations have an impact on Scotland's natural heritage in certain areas. We need to continue to take steps to minimise these impacts." And I would also point out generally that the, before I come to my two amendments, that the Land Reform Review Group also had concerns following its investigations about the limited progress made. To actually move to the amendments 119 and 120, 119 is to consider the creation of a legal duty on landowners to implement the Code of Practice on Deer Management 2012. And I want to give a very quick summary as I understand it, and having had discussion with those outside the Parliament who know a lot more than I do about this issue, that in 2011, and as part of the consultation exercise relating to deer provisions of the Wayne Act, the Wildlife and Natural Environment Act Scotland, the Deer Commission Scotland proposed a duty on landowners to manage deer sustainably. And it was to deliver a better balance between the rights enjoyed by landowners in relation to deer and the responsibilities that should accompany these rights. And it is a concern, I believe now, that it's reached the point where without the legal duty to manage deer sustainably, the deer code being not legally binding has become a really serious issue. And I propose that the creation of a legal duty on land managers to implement the deer code should now be brought in, and that we shouldn't be waiting for the review, which will come before a committee in the next Parliament. It should be supported in terms of enforcement by existing offences related to non-compliance and the ability of SNH to recover costs, similar to the current provisions in relation to the control schemes in the Deer Scotland Act 2000... And, sorry, I'm very bad with numbers. 1996. The Code of Practice on Deer Management sets out and defines the public interests and provides for benchmarks of standards. And I don't think there's been concern previously about the effect on small landowners for the issues that we've just been looking at in terms of rates for shooting rights. And I don't think that this provision, although there has been some concern expressed about it, will affect small landowners if discretion is used as to who SNH apply the duty. And this provision would also be linked only with those landowners who receive a statutory cull notice return notification. who have to say what numbers they're culling from under existing powers. So the amendment creates an offence of failing, if it goes through, of failing to comply with a notice of non-compliance with the codes of practice, and such a notice may be appealed, as I've said in the amendment, to the Land Court. But if not appealed, or if upheld at appeal, it becomes an offence not to comply. This, therefore, in effect, creates a duty on owners and occupiers to comply with the code of practice, or risk SNH giving notice of non-compliance and then, if not complied with, committing an offence. This is similar to the Land Management Order procedure, I understand, provided in the Nature Conservation Scotland Act of 2004, although I didn't know that before being given that information. 120 is a general enabling power to allow Scottish Government ministers to make provision by regulation for SNH to take actions for improved deer management. And sustainable deer management is required for the delivery of a range of public policy outputs. And therefore, it is proposed by this amendment that Scottish ministers should be able to provide to improve SNH's powers in relation to deer management by a more straightforward process of regulation. And that I'm asking that is approved by affirmative instrument. This power would better enable SNH, on behalf of the Scottish Government, to make quicker and more responsive decisions, in my view, to manage deer in the public interest and without the need for primary legislation. This approach would have public safeguards in that it would still need Scottish Parliament approval and the advice of ministers. And I'm also very keen to listen to my colleague Mike Russell's arguments for amendments 1 and 2. So I move, is it 119? I move in my name, I think. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Mike Russell to speak to Amendment 1 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I think it's very important at the outset to say that the deer issue in Scotland is not a new one. The roots of the deer problem, and there is a deer problem in Scotland, arise in the 19th century with the establishment of about a million and a half hectares of private deer forests, that is, essentially private hunting estates. And since the mid-19th century, there have been no less than seven government-appointed inquiries into the issue of red deer in Scotland. The last of those, after the Second World War, resulted in the establishment of the Red Deer Commission in 1959. And I'm grateful to Simon Pepper for what is a wonderful analysis of the process since then, which he's provided as a private paper. He points out that in 1959, Frank Fraser Darling, who was the advisor to the Red Deer Commission, suggested that the optimum number of red deer in Scotland would be 60,000. Today there are something between 350 and 400,000. And there's also an increasing number of roe, sika and fallow deer. And the Scottish deer population is now well over 500,000. And his analysis of the reports of the Red Deer Commission and then the Deer Commission and then SNH since then show an extraordinary story of the failure of public policy. And you can't put it in any other way. And I do have to say that as Environment Minister myself for over 2 years, I wish I had known this at the time. Because the reality is that the public bodies repeatedly, year after year, pleaded with private owners to take effective action. And year after year, that did not happen. From 1959 onwards, and there had been considerable debate before then, from 1959 onwards, there has been an argument for change, and that change has not happened. And even when there has been limited legislative change, it's actually produced virtually no effect. Now, this is not a criticism of the individuals involved, for example, in the deer management groups. I've met with some of those in recent weeks. I do think people engaged in this activity are genuinely committed to change. But that change is almost impossible to achieve now because the sheer numbers are so great. If I can just remind members of the committee, in order to simply stop the growth of numbers, you would require to cull a third of the population every year. That is clearly now an impossibility, given the numbers. And so the problem with deer population simply goes on getting worse. And although in some areas it is broadly contained, in other areas it is completely out of control. In the area in which I live, it is completely out of control. and it is impossible to grow trees in unfenced areas. The optimum number of deer per hectare for that is massively increased. And if you go back and look at some of these reports, you discover that the same things that this committee was talking about when it looked at this in the bill are talked about in the reports. In 1965, the report said that deer stocks could be greatly improved in quality if numbers were reduced, but nothing happened. In 1970, effective conservation and control of red deer must begin with efficient management of deer. This is the annual report of the Red Deer Commission. 1987, with few notable exceptions, the passage of another year has seen little success in reducing the population of red deer. And so it goes on. 1989, the 30th anniversary of the Red Deer Commission, the chairman's statement in the report said, 30 years on and no improvement. And now we are in 2016 and we're facing exactly, in fact, no, we're facing a worse problem. So my amendments are, in fact, very, very modest proposals. I'm grateful to the help of Environment Link and others for putting them together, but actually, they get nowhere near tackling this problem. They will help SNH to begin to take some action. And I have to say that although the officers on the ground in SNH are very active, I have to say the management of SNH has been completely supine in this matter. And I said before at this committee, the merger that took place with SNH has not produced the results that it should. And when the Scottish Government reviews the issue of deer later this year, I do hope it will look first of all at the evidence of the reports of the Red Deer Commission and the Deer Commission and SNH, and it will draw the inevitable conclusion that there requires a major change in public policy in order to tackle the issue of deer in Scotland. Because the number of deer in Scotland is out of control. There is no question about it. It cannot be disputed. And the good work of deer management groups in various parts of the country is succeeding perhaps in stemming the tide, but it is doing no more than that. So we have a considerable environmental problem in Scotland of our own making, created by the circumstances of the 19th century, not managed effectively by public policy since that time, which now requires major initiatives. And if we can wake Scotland up to that by the small things we might do today, then I hope that in future months and years, then a future Scottish Government will determine to tackle this much more radically. Because it is vital for the environmental well-being of the country. It's also vital for the well-being of the deer, and it certainly is very important in terms of how we take the whole of Scottish public policy on land forward. So I'm proposing motions that are modest. I certainly think Claudia Beamish's amendments are also of importance, but I am looking for the Scottish Government to recognise that the time is now right for a major rethink of where we've come from.
Any other members wish to comment at the moment? No other members. I just want to point out... Sorry, Alec Ferguson, yes, thank you. You've just indicated.
I'm very torn on all of this, and I'm very aware of Mike Russell's considerable expertise in this matter, particularly from his constituency interest and the problems of deer management in my part of Scotland are very different from the problems of deer management in his part of Scotland and indeed further north. But I have some difficulties with his amendments, which he might be able to satisfy me on in winding up later. But he talks about a major change in public policy needs to come about. But my own belief is that any major change in public policy needs to go hand in hand with private interests and private buy-in to the policy aims that are being put on the table. In other words, it's my belief that these are most effective when they are part of a consensual process. And my concern about his amendment number 2 is that this becomes a very top-down process and that SNH would have the ability, if I read this right, to rewrite sections of a deer management plan and put it back to the affected deer management group without any further consultation whatsoever. And I worry about the top-down approach that seems to me to exemplify. I'm also a little concerned about amendment number 3, which asks for cull returns to include forward predictions. Now, my understanding is that that is already part of deer management plans, and that if this amendment to be accepted, it would simply involve a degree of duplication and other administrative costs that I believe to be unnecessary. I'm concerned about Claudia Beamish's amendments in that they seem to me to apply statutory requirements for codes of practice, which are not in themselves statutory in nature. They are codes of practice provide guidance, not statutory requirements, and I have a difficulty with that equation, if I could put it that way. So maybe those could be addressed by both the Minister and Mr. Russell and Ms. Beamish as this goes on, but I'll listen carefully to the debate before deciding how to vote.
Thank you. Graeme Day.
Very briefly, just to pick up on Mr. Ferguson's point, I hear his concerns about the top-down approach, but I would say briefly that seeking consensus self-evidently has not worked. That's where we are today.
Yes, certainly.
I know this is not a normal debate, but I think I have to come back on that. We don't yet know. We know where we are today, but as members are very aware, this committee has taken a very robust position on deer management, and we've put in place the ability for the government to have a review during 2016 and be ready to act at the end of it. I think it is much too early to say that we are not having any impact on this, and I restate my concerns in this regard.
In that regard, I would like to add a few remarks about the very first chair of the Red Deer Commission, Major Crichton Stewart, who served a term and a half and resigned. And he was quoted in the Glasgow Herald of September 23, 1963, as saying, "The last report of the Red Deer Commission complained that lack of cooperation from farmers and landowners could cripple it in its task, which is to reduce the red deer population of the Highlands to manageable proportions." And indeed, it's all the more pressing today as we have a much wider range of landowners, some of them small, such as community land trusts, some of them are non-governmental organisations as well as shooting organisations. And it would seem to me that the way in which this is operated could well, in areas of crisis, such as in Assent, in my constituency, bear down upon a community trust which does have a need of a small income, and not on people who shoot for pleasure and therefore have no likely pecuniary interest in carrying out the kinds of culls which are necessary, nor indeed on the NGO, the John Muir Trust, whose stated national policy is not to allow fencing and so on in areas where there are threats to trees. I understand that in the circumstances of this debate that we have to take into account the realities on the ground, but I think that the words of Major Crichton Stewart in 1963 suggest to us today that we cannot wait any longer for this kind of action to take place. And I hope that the Minister will take the seriousness of Mr. Russell's amendment into account. Any other members need to comment? No. Minister, to respond.
Thank you, Convener. And I think before I address this group of important amendments in detail, and I think perhaps with the committee's agreement, I would like to set out some context in relation to ongoing action in deer management planning as a way of trying to help the committee in its consideration of this issue more broadly. Now, I've noted the concerns of the committee on the issue of deer management. I take those concerns extremely seriously. And of course, you know, the key step in the future of deer management in Scotland is a review that was agreed with this committee. Now, I think Claudia Beamish mentioned the 2014 Deer Management Group Assessment by SNH. That was intended to set a baseline for the 2016 review. But I think given the concerns that we have heard at stage one, you know, we are absolutely determined and committed to seeing an improvement in the management of deer to protect the public interest. Now, we've taken the significant step of bringing that review forward so that it will be completed during the course of this year. And if the review points to us to the need to make major changes to the legislation governing deer management, we will then be in a position to take action, to develop proposals, and will consult sooner rather than later. Now, I recognise that this increases the pressure on the deer sector to step up and prove absolutely that the current system can deliver effective management. But I am confident that they too will also recognise the concerns that have been expressed here in Parliament and the need for concerted action. Now, turning to the review and how that will be carried out, the review will focus on the key question: has there been a step change in the effectiveness of deer management? That review will be evidence-based and factual, drawing on, firstly, an assessment of progress of deer management group plans in meeting the public interest. Secondly, data on the condition of protected areas. And thirdly, a review of the outcomes of existing Section 7 voluntary agreements. Now, the Scottish National Heritage Report will evaluate evidence from both upland deer management group areas and the lowlands of Scotland. And in compiling that report, the SNH will seek data and evidence from other organisations. They will also liaise with the Association of Deer Management Groups regarding progress on the deer management group plans. It will be providing a report to ministers by the end of October. A baseline has been established and work is already in hand to gather the data and the evidence. Now, SNH will also put in place an internal quality assurance process which will ensure that the evidence presented is robust. Staff resources have been allocated within SNH and a project manager put in place to ensure that that deadline is met. So I hope that some of those details will reassure the committee that the review will be as comprehensive as well as fair and measured, and that we are absolutely, as a government and as a Minister for the Environment, absolutely determined and committed to see a real improvement in how our deer are managed. Now, I met with the chair of SNH last week. We discussed the importance of making sure that we have a timely and a robust review process, and I have no doubt that this is understood by all those involved in the process. Now, turning to the amendments, convener, because I'm conscious of time, I would like to thank Claudia Beamish for explaining her amendments 119, 120 and 121. Amendment 119 obviously creates a mechanism whereby non-compliance with the SNH's Code of Practice on Deer Management could become a criminal offence. Now, that code was introduced under the Wildlife and Natural Environment Scotland Act relatively recently. It was approved by Parliament under the affirmative procedure coming into effect from the 1st of January 2012. As we know, the code is intended to support our deer managers with that practical guidance in setting out responsibilities of our owners and occupiers of land with deer on their land, and it has various categories of guidance. It sets out the legal obligations on owners and occupiers, and it also sets out advice on best practice and advice that might apply only in particular circumstances. Now, whilst I really do appreciate, I think, the sentiment behind Claudia Beamish's amendment, I don't believe that it would be appropriate to create a mechanism whereby non-compliance with the code became an offence. Now, that the amendment itself would essentially mean that the code would have to be redrawn to reflect its altered purpose. It would have to be more prescriptive and would end up, I think, providing less useful help and guidance, and so reduce the support that is available to our deer managers. The current code has not only been helpful to individual deer managers, but it has also been used in the deer management group assessment process, where the public interest criteria that's used in that process were drawn from the code. And I understand absolutely that there is a desire to see some teeth behind the code and the requirement for effective deer management. And I would like to remind the committee that, you know, in this respect, the SNH already has significant intervention powers, which we are already adding to through the provisions in this bill. They have the power to call for a voluntary agreement to deliver specified deer management measures under Section 7 of the Deer Act. And if those measures are not delivered, then SNH can move to compel
landowners and deer managers through the use of a Section 8 control scheme. Now, as the committee knows, we are significantly increasing the penalty for non-compliance with a Section 8 control scheme in this bill, and this hierarchy of intervention powers available to SNH, I think, is more focused than a new offence of failing to comply with the code. I mean, SNH is required to have regard to the code in exercising these powers of intervention, and I believe that's an appropriate role for the code to have. So whilst I understand the intention behind this amendment, I think for all the reasons that I've set out, I cannot support this amendment, and I would ask Claudia Beamish to withdraw this. I think in terms of Amendment 120, I would thank Claudia Beamish for, I think, the thought that has gone into this amendment, and certainly appreciate that this could be useful in certain circumstances. Now, we're not always able to predict situations that could arise in deer management, and there may be situations where we would wish to take action to address situations, for example, you know, like where the Code of Practice on Deer Management strongly advises a course of action, but deer managers are routinely not complying with the advice. Now, we could, in those circumstances, consider whether that part of the code could be strengthened by further regulatory action. There are some problems with the amendment as it's drafted, however, because, for example, there's no provision, I think, for penalties for non-compliance with the new regulations, and the powers are rather wide. It's also, I think, not realistic or fair for a legal duty to comply with the code to apply only to some owners and managers and not to all. So what I'd like to suggest to Claudia Beamish is that if this amendment is withdrawn, and that myself and my officials between now and stage three, that we work with Claudia Beamish with the aim of coming back with a much more tightly drafted provision that could assist SNH in ensuring that we have sustainable deer management. With Amendment 121, convener, that amendment provides for a penalty in relation to the requirement to comply with a Code of Practice Enforcement Order under Amendment 119. I'd also ask that this amendment be withdrawn. In terms of the amendments from Mr. Russell, I would like to thank Mike Russell for setting out the rationale behind his amendments 1, 2, 3 and 4 and for the detailed work that has gone into these. I recognise and fully support the intention behind Amendment 1 in encouraging more consultation and engagement with the local community and interested parties on the development of deer management plans, absolutely. But I think the process that is set out in this amendment is a little bit cumbersome. I'm also advised that it is legally problematic because it defines, for example, the legal owners and occupiers to which it applies by reference to membership of a deer management group. However, deer management groups at the moment, they have no legal status, and membership of them is neither compulsory, nor do they cover all of the deer habitat in Scotland. Now, the amendment also does not provide for the publication of the plans in draft or final form, so that could be problematic given the trigger for the proposed provision is the development of a new plan. So it could actually provide a disincentive to the production of new plans, which I know certainly would not be Mr. Russell's intention. I do greatly support and I very much welcome the intention behind these amendments, as I said, in the fact that they address issues of transparency and opportunities for community engagement. But I would suggest to the committee that I think there are other ways to achieve what Amendment 1 is trying to do. The benchmark for deer management groups includes a communications section and advises that local consultation should be accessible and advises that local consultation should be carried out during the plan's development. Now, no action is being taken to place deer management plans on the Association of the Deer Management Groups website. I'm on there just about every day checking to see what progress is being made. And finally, as the committee will be aware, the deer provisions already included in the bill include a provision which allows new functions to be conferred on deer panels with a view to facilitating improved consultation and communication, I think, with the local community. So while
Absolutely, I completely support the spirit of Michael Russell's amendment for all the reasons I've set out. I would ask Mr. Russell if he would consider withdrawing his Amendment 1. As regards Amendment 2, I would expect that in practice there would be dialogue between SNH and the owners or occupiers served with a notice, Section 6A, requiring them to prepare a deer management plan, allowing for modifications to any plan under preparation to be made. However, I can see that there is benefit in formalising this position in legislation, so I'm happy to accept Mr. Russell's amendment, which clarifies this. On Amendment 3, I am extremely sympathetic to the intention behind this amendment in the fact that it will provide a focus and a reminder for all that while there are a number of aspects to deer management, it will nearly always be important to keep a control on numbers. Now, there is a technical issue, however, convener, with the way this amendment is drafted, in that the offence in the Deer Act, which attaches to the requirement to provide a cull return, would also attach to this new requirement to provide a cull projection. Now, the offence also applies to the provision of false data, and clearly this will be difficult to interpret when applied to projections. So I'm proposing that while I'm happy to accept this amendment, I should say I think we'll probably wish to give, I think, further thought as to the operation of the offence that is linked to the new requirement, and I think come back at stage 3 with Mr. Russell with an amendment that addresses those concerns. Turning lastly, convener, to Amendment 4, I of course recognise the concern that the committee and others have raised in relation to the timing of the commencement of the deer provisions. I've listened to those concerns very carefully. I have decided that the provisions should be commenced as soon as it is practicable to do so, rather than the original intention of awaiting the outcome of the review. Now, these provisions provide SNH with additional useful powers to intervene in support of sustainable deer management, and it is right that we make these powers available to them. But I must resist Amendment 4, which commences the provisions the day after Royal Assent. It is the practice for, I think, certain technical provisions to be commenced at that point, but it isn't normal practice for substantive provisions to be brought into force so quickly, and certainly not provisions with offences attached. However, as I have already made clear, we recognise the imperative to move quickly. We've brought forward the review, and alongside that, I will commit to commencing the deer provisions as soon as practicable, and that'll be approximately 2 months after Royal Assent, and I trust that the committee will accept that commitment. So given this commitment, I would ask Mr. Russell if he would consider withdrawing Amendment 4.
Thank you, Minister. Claudia Beamish, to wind up, press or withdraw.
Right, thank you, Convener. And I would like to, first of all, start by thanking Scottish Environment Link and others who have a wide knowledge of these issues, and also I have gained some knowledge of it through committee. And I have to say that it is disappointing that my amendment 119 is not going to be accepted, because while I understand what the Minister is saying about that it could make it less useful in some way, the code, I think it is really important now, the time has come for compliance with the code, and I don't think that we should be waiting any longer. Alex Ferguson said, if I got it right, that he thought it was too early. I think it's too late, and I think Mike Russell's opening remarks summed up very well the reasons for concern across Scotland, both in Highland and Lowland areas. So I am disappointed about that, and I just want to highlight as well from the evidence that we had in committee that Section 8 was proving hard to take forward, and I know that there's some movement on that, but I think that sort of is part of that picture as well. While I've listened carefully to what the Minister's saying, I don't intend to withdraw that amendment. I'm very pleased with the offer to talk about Amendment 120, and understand, of course, that there's no point having an expectation that groups or individuals would comply with something without having any penalty. So this rather makes sense to have a discussion about that, and I hope that we may be able to reach an agreement on that before stage three. So I'm pleased about that. And I just really want to highlight what a serious issue this is, finally, and I'm keen to listen to what Mike Russell says about his amendments. And I also want just to have on the record that the amendments that I've tried to take forward and the remarks I've made in no way are to disparage those deer management groups that are working well, but an attempt to get a grip on a very serious situation, and I think now is the time to make a more robust start on it. Thank you.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 119 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
No, we're not agreed. Will those show who are in favour of Amendment 119? Raise your hands. 1, 2. Those who are against 119 now show. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6. And those who have abstained?
17. It was a mistake.
We'll count those who are against. Those who are against again, please.
6. 6.
We got it correct. Thank you. And those who abstain? 1. So the amendment is not agreed to. Call Amendment 1 in the name of Mike Russell, already debated with Amendment 119. Mike Russell, to move or not move?
I accept the legal objection. I will not move on this.
Not move. One. Okay. The question is that Amendment 2 in the name of Mike Russell, already debated with Amendment 119. Mike Russell, to move or not move?
I think I'll move as the Minister accepts it.
Mike Russell, the question is Amendment 2 be agreed to? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. Those who are in favour of the amendment, two, please show. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Thank you. Those against? Those abstaining? 1. 8 for, none against, and 1 abstained. So therefore, amendment 2 is agreed to. Call amendment 120 in the name of Claudia Beamish, already debated with amendment 119. Claudia Beamish, to move or not move?
Not move, convener.
Not move. Okay, the call amendment 121 in the name of Claudia Beamish, already debated with 119. Claudia Beamish, to move or not move?
Sorry, convener.
Calling amendment 121 in the name of Claudia Beamish,
right, okay.
Already debated with, yeah. Amendment 119.
Right, not moved.
Not moved. The question is that section 70 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 3 in the name of Michael Russell, already debated with Amendment 119. Mike Russell, to move or not move?
Moved.
Mike Russell has moved. Therefore, is the committee agreed with Mike Russell's amendment? No. We'll have a vote. Those in favour of Amendment 3, please show. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And those against? No. Those abstaining? 1. The answer is 8 for, none against, and 1 abstained. So therefore, Mike Russell's amendment 3 has been agreed. Therefore, the question is that section 71 to 73 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed, and suspend. Now, thank Aileen McLeod for all her efforts in this part of the bill, and if she could take a back seat for a short while on this matter. Thank you.
Alex,
we'll take 5 minutes.
Have you got just 1 minute?
Okay. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary and his officials. We move to the question of repairing tenancies. And call Amendment 154 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Group with amendments as shown in the groupings list. I would point out that Amendments 187, 188, 189, 190 and 191 in this group are preempted by Amendment 298 in the group, retention of existing procedures for the variation or rent of review of rent. I note that Amendment 188 is also preempted by Amendment 299 in the group, limited duration tenancies and modern limited duration tenancies determination of initial rent. I also point out that Amendment 262 in this group is preempted by Amendment 153 in the group, application of repairing standard to agricultural tenancies, etc. The Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 154 and speak to all the amendments in the group. Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning to the committee. If I can speak to Amendment 154 and say, Convener, that although it comes earlier in the bill, Amendment 154 is consequential to Amendments 159 to 165, which create the new form of agricultural lease called a repairing tenancy. This amendment amends Section 74 of the bill to make it clear in the new Section 5A1 of the 2003 Act that a modern limited duration tenancy, an MLDT, cannot be a repairing tenancy. Turning to the other amendments, can I also propose Amendments 159, 160, 161, 162, 160, 164 and 165, which provide for the new tenancy type, repairing tenancies, as recommended by the review group and this committee in your Stage 1 report. The aim of the repairing tenancy is to give a future to holdings which are in a poor state of repair or abandoned and bring them up to a standard to enable them to be farmed effectively. We can all think of derelict farms in all of our constituencies, I'm sure, which, if they were inhabited and managed well, could make a real difference and positive impact on the communities that surround them. Repairing tenancies have the potential to be one of the keys to release a stronger, more vibrant and sustainable future for those communities. This set of amendments creates the structure and key features of the new tenancy. Amendment 159 provides that the tenancy will last for at least 35 years. The tenancy will begin with a repairing period, which is the period of at least 5 years from the commencement of the tenancy. The intention is that the tenant use the repairing period to bring the holding up to a standard that enables it to be farmed effectively. During the repairing period, the tenant is exempt from having to comply with the rules of good husbandry. This is out of fairness to the tenant in taking on the burden of improving a holding in bad repair, and so they can use that time to bring the holding up to a standard that enables it to be farmed effectively. Amendment 162 contains provisions which set out the use and treatment of fixed equipment present on the holding at the start of the tenancy and how fixed equipment is to be considered during the rest of the tenancy. In the repairing period, the tenant is by default responsible for providing and maintaining the fixed equipment they need to be able to farm effectively, although the landlord can provide fixed equipment if both parties agree. After the repairing period, the tenant is by default responsible for maintenance and the landlord is responsible for any renewal or replacement. Again, of course, parties can agree to divide responsibility differently if they so prefer. There's also provision to ensure the tenant is not required to pay whole or part of any fire insurance premium for fixed equipment, as this should be done by the landlord. Amendment 161 allows for repairing tenancies to contain a break clause, enabling the tenant to terminate the lease at any time up to the end of the repairing period. So they've got a get-out option if they decide it's not working out for them. Then, at the end of the repairing tenancy, unless the parties terminate the lease, it will continue on for a period of 7 years, in the same way as proposed for MLDTs by Amendment 156. Amendment 163 provides some protection for the tenant's investment in the holding by preventing the landlord from resuming the land or any part of it during the repairing period or until 5 years after the end of the repairing period. Amendment 164 also prevents the landlord from irritating the lease during the repairing period on the grounds that the tenant is not farming the holding in accordance with the rules of good husbandry. After the repairing period, the landlord would be able to irritate the lease on the same grounds as provided for in Section 78 of the Bill for MLDTs. Amendment 165 gives the Scottish Ministers power to make regulations to apply the compensation provisions of Part 4 of the 2003 Act to repairing tenancies with such changes as are needed. So these amendments are supported by 54 additional and consequential amendments. So if the committee would want me to go through these, clearly I'm happy to do that, or I can skip and just conclude this part of the discussion. I don't know if the convener wants to take a vote on that or just give an indication. I get an impression you're happy to skip the consequentials.
But presume that there are no other substantive matters in the...
Okay, well, in that case, I'll just conclude by just making the point that Rome wasn't built in a day, and neither will these farms where repairing tenancies are aimed at. It's going to take hard work, goodwill and strong business relationships for these tenancies to work, and I don't think we should underestimate the scale of effort that lies ahead for the tenants and landlords to take up these repairing tenancies, but I also don't underestimate the scale of positive impact these new types of tenancies can have in the future of our tenancy sector and rural Scotland, and that's why I believe they've attracted widespread support. So accordingly, I officially move Amendment 154.
Thank you very much. Other members wish to comment on this just now? Alec Ferguson.
Thank you, Convener. I hope you'll forgive me if I just make a general comment at the outset of Part 10 of the Bill. And I just wish to do so because, as members and indeed the Cabinet Secretary will be aware, I dissented from Part 10 in the Stage 1 report for reasons that I put on the record at that time. Those reasons, as far as I'm concerned, still stand, not the least of which is I've always believed that this part of the Bill would have been better if it had been a separate piece of legislation, which delivered the entire package of the AHLRG, which the Cabinet Secretary who chaired that group and the group were indeed at pains to put forward as a total package at that time. I can only say that I think there's been a degree of sort of cherry-picking within the recommendations of the report since then, and we've been told that a number of issues are due to time constraints. I see that there have been no time constraints in relation to these amendments, and I'm very pleased about that. I wish that it was the case that the time constraints didn't impact on other parts of the bill, but we'll come to that in due course. Having dissented from that part, I fully intend to play what I see as a productive role as this part is taken forward. I would wish to move amendments that I think would improve the bill. I don't expect many of them to be agreed, but that's what I will do, and play what I hope is a positive role as this debate continues. That said, I fully support the intentions of these amendments. I think we were all happy to see repairing tenancies. We might have had some debate about the length of a repairing tenancy, but I will not be opposing this set of amendments today, and I welcome its inclusion in Part 10 of the bill.
Thank you. Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. I'm not going to take up any more time other than to say that I am positive about these amendments, and that just to note that the Land Reform Review Group was supportive, but also just to ask the Cabinet Secretary how the decision was made about the initial 5 years, and wonder whether it might be more appropriate to consider a slightly longer time in view of some comments I've had from STFA about the difficulty of maybe getting a holding back into a good state if it's dilapidated within the period of 5 years. So I'm just highlighting that point.
Thank you. So, the Cabinet Secretary to wind up.
Thank you, and thank you to the committee's support for these amendments. In relation to the five-year timeline asked about by Claudia Beamish, clearly because it's open to both parties to agree a longer timescale if they so wish, we looked at 5 years as a reasonable minimum period, and there's the other conditions within that that give people a lot of flexibility, so that's really just a rationale behind that.
And you've already proposed this. The question is that Amendment 154 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes. Agreed.
We are agreed. I call modern limited duration tenancies break clauses. Call Amendment 155, the name of the Cabinet Secretary in a group of its own. Cabinet Secretary to move and speak to Amendment 155.
OK, Convener, Amendment 155 has the effect that when a short limited duration tenancy converts into an MLDT in the various circumstances provided for in Section 5A, which the Bill inserts into the 2003 Act, there is no option of a break clause after 5 years. This is because the break clause is targeted specifically at new entrants, not at more established farmers who have already been farming for some time under other leases. So I move Amendment 155.
Thank you. Any members wish to comment on that just now? Cabinet Secretary, wind up? No? Thank you very much. The question is Amendment 155 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Question is that Section 74 be agreed to. Are we agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Question is that Section 75 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Modern limited duration tenancies and the 1991 Act tenancies compensation for tenants' improvements on termination. Call Amendment 272 in the name of Claudia Beamish, group with Amendment 282. Claudia Beamish to move Amendment 272 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. These amendments look at the WAGO process, and my first amendment requires notices to quit to specify the amount of compensation that has already been agreed between the landlord and tenant or decided by arbitration, and also requires the landlord to give earlier intimation of his or her proposed amount of compensation and or his or her intention to refer the matter to arbitration if agreement can't be reached. The option of referral to arbitration to settle on a fair amount where agreement cannot be reached will prevent a situation, in my belief, where the tenant could block the notice to quit by refusing to agree the amount. In relation to MLDTs, there is already provision in the Bill and in the 2003 Act, respectively, as I understand it, for that earlier intimation to be given, so the amendments merely add a new condition to what the intimation must conclude. The two-stage WAGO process would apply only in relation to a notice to quit if the problem being addressed is that the tenant is liable to be on the back foot when negotiating WAGO, having already been served a notice to quit. And I move the First Amendment in my name.
Thank you. Any other member wish to comment? No. Cabinet Secretary, respond.
Convener, Amendments 272 and 282 propose changes to both the 91 and 2003 Acts by including a new section in this Bill. So far as they relate to the termination of 1991 Act tenancies, SLDTs as well, LDTs and MLDTs, they propose a two-stage WAGO process for 1991 Act tenancies and these other leases and an agreement process for compensation for SLDTs. While I agree with the principle that a two-stage WAGO process may be beneficial to the parties in some circumstances, this amendment would require significant policy development, and this is something I'm not in favour of at the moment because we'd have to rush that through this process. Instead, I'd like to make a commitment to the committee to explore this option further in the future and to highlight areas in the Bill at the moment which I believe will make the WAGO process as fair and as transparent as possible. Firstly, though looking at the amendments put forward by Claudia Beamish, I can already see a problem with their operation. The notice to quit requires the landlord to specify an amount of compensation agreed between the parties, but there's no link to assessment of that compensation under Part 4. This could allow parties to undercut the statutory minimum level of compensation provided for by Part 4 and could result in the tenant receiving inadequate compensation for their investment made. The amendments would also require the landlord to identify a sum for compensation for improvements that hadn't even happened yet. It would very likely result in a lot of arbitration, with all the costs and delay that would potentially entail before landlords could terminate their tenancies. Tenancies are entitled to compensation for things other than improvements under Part 4, such as compensation for what is known as high farming, but the amendment doesn't cover that. This reinforces the point that we need time to examine carefully how any new legislation on this issue cuts across the existing legislation on compensation to ensure that tenants are not disadvantaged. This reinforces the point that we need time to examine carefully how any new legislation on this issue cuts across the existing legislation on compensation to ensure that tenants are not disadvantaged. My understanding is that one of the most common problems encountered at WAGO is that parties cannot agree on what fixed equipment has been provided by each during the tenancy. making it difficult to establish what items are eligible for compensation and therefore leading to compensation disputes. Indeed, during their 18-month review of this issue and the range of complexities potentially involved that was examined by the review group, they concluded that, and I quote, effective recording of an agreement on a tenant's investment and improvements is central to fair and predictable compensation at WAGO. Acknowledging that, in reality, many tenants and landlords do not have adequate records, the review group recommended a time-limited amnesty process during which tenants could establish what items would be due for compensation at WAGO. So that this bill, at the moment, drives forward this recommendation, also seeks to address the issue of inadequate record-keeping by placing a requirement on both parties when entering into an MLDD to agree in writing a schedule of fixed equipment, which will set out the fixed equipment provided by the landlord and a provision for the parties to amend that schedule at any time during the lease. This means going forward, parties will have the adequate documentation, hopefully, required to enable fairness and transparency at WAGO. So while sympathetic to the desire for a two-stage WAGO process, significant policy work, we believe, would be required, and there's not time for that during this bill process. I believe the provisions in the bill will alleviate some of the problems experienced at WAGO, and I urge the committee to not support the amendment put forward in Claudia's name.
So, Claudia Beamish, to wind up and press her withdrawal.
Thank you, Convener. I think it was helpful that the Cabinet Secretary has outlined what there is in the bill for the record already. My concern has been to help facilitate the most easy way for people to leave their farms when they want, and this has been quite a complex issue for many farmers, and in order to facilitate new entrants coming in and the succession of younger farmers as well, or I should say assignation in these cases. I do hear what the Cabinet Secretary says, but there has been quite a lot of requests from STFA and some others about the possibility of a two-stage WAGO. So I'm a bit concerned about the lack of time scale on what the Cabinet Secretary is saying. And I wonder if, in view of the fact that there has been comment previously, it's not a sort of new idea that I've brought up by any means, whether it might be possible to meet to discuss whether it would be realistic to look at stage three. But if not, to get some sort of more definite timescale on these suggested amendments.
Cabinet Secretary.
I mean, clearly, I want to take the opportunity today to give a commitment to the committee. We recognise it's a very real issue and do want to work on it. And clearly, whilst no amendments would come forward, most likely until the next Parliament, given the lack of timescale with this bill in this Parliament. As Claudia Beamish says, it's an issue that has been raised with us by the tenant farmers' representatives. So it's a very real issue, we understand that. But because some of the parts of the bill do address some of the concerns that this two-stage process is meant to address, we have to be careful that we don't rush into something that cuts across other parts of the bill. So I'm happy to give a commitment that we will make sure this is addressed as early as possible in the next Parliament.
Thank you.
Claudia Beamish to press or withdraw.
I'll withdraw at the moment and consider whether I should take something back which is somewhat more clear and robust at stage three, but I'm listening to what the Cabinet Secretary is saying.
Claudia Beamish is asked to withdraw Amendment 272 with the agreement of the committee. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? No member objects to the amendment being withdrawn. So, modern limited duration tenancies continuation, call amendment 156, the name of the Cabinet Secretary in a group of its own. Cabinet Secretary to move and speak to amendment 156.
This amendment will reduce the continuation timescale of an MLDT from 10 years to 7 years. During stage one evidence sessions, the committee heard from stakeholders who felt that a 10-year continuation term was too long. We have taken these concerns on board. This amendment seeks to balance stakeholders' desire for a shorter continuation term with the need to make sure that we don't prevent tenants from qualifying for the Scottish Rural Development Programme grants. Because some of these grant schemes require a tenant to be able to demonstrate that the tenant will have control over the land for at least 5 years. And when you factor in the application process, which can take over a year in some cases, a continuation term of 7 years will ensure that tenants will still be able to claim those grants, while giving both the tenant and the landlord the flexibility of a shorter term than the original 10 years. So I move Amendment 156.
Any member wish to comment on that? Alec Ferguson.
To comment on this, I'm very supportive of this amendment, and I hope the convener will bear with me if I just make one comment, because if I'd been thinking a little bit quicker on my feet, I would have moved the amendment that Claudia Beamish has just withdrawn. I do think that the Cabinet Secretary's response to that section has totally exemplified my real concerns about this bill, in that it is time constraints that have prevented this hugely important issue going forward. But I appreciate that I may be stretching your patience, convener, and I will simply say that I very much support this amendment.
We are extremely indulgent, of course. The question is that Amendment 156 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 76 be agreed to. Are we agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Section 77. The question is, are we agreed to it? We are agreed. Modern limited duration tenancies and 1991 Act tenancies, irritancy of lease due to non-payment of rent. Call Amendment 134 in the name of Claudia Beamish, group with Amendment 275. Claudia Beamish to move Amendment 134 and speak to both amendments in the group. Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. I move Amendment 134, and this amendment concerns irritancy of a lease for non-payment of rent, where irritancy should not be possible if the landlord has served an invoice and given reasonable opportunity for the tenant to remedy. This amendment only relates to the new MLDTs. The removal of a 1991 tenancy for non-payment of rent is governed by, I understand, Section 20 of the 91 Act, and by the terms of some leases that allow the landlord to irritate the lease, which I think is a legal term, for non-payment after 6 months, even if no invoice has been served and no reminder or opportunity to remedy has been offered to the tenant. This amendment tries to ensure that the tenant may have a reasonable opportunity, as is stated in the amendment, to make a late payment and ensure the landlord must issue an invoice. This will, I hope, assuage fears that a landowner might fail to issue a tenant an invoice for rent in the hope that, through an accumulation of missed rent, rent payments, this could give cause for eviction. And then on the other amendment, 275, this amendment ensures the same legislation applies to all tenancies, limited duration tenancies, short limited duration tenancies, 91 Act tenancies. As irritancy is not currently covered in Part 10 otherwise than in Chapter 1, it is necessary to create a new chapter for it. It has been put as a suggestion after Chapter 4, as there is some common ground with the connection with rent and rent reviews. The outcome in terms of the degree of protection this affords tenants varies according to the type of tenancy. A tenant under the 91 Act can have proceedings against him or her commenced only after the rent has been unpaid for at least 6 months. Under the others, the lease can be irritated soon after a single rent payment is overdue. The reasonable opportunity clause stands for all tenancies, however, and this difference is just to reflect the length of the tenancy and the security of the tenure. In the amendment to Section 20, I have left in a reference to a reasonable opportunity. This may appear unnecessary. If the rent is 6 months overdue, the tenant must surely already have had a more than reasonable opportunity to pay, but I think it does add something. If the rent is due monthly and the last five payments are overdue, the landlord could, under Section 20 as it stands, commence proceedings the day after the due date of the six-monthly payment without giving the tenant, and again I quote, a reasonable opportunity to make the sixth payment. And that's where I'm hoping that the Cabinet Secretary will agree with.
Mike Russell.
I have a great deal of sympathy for this amendment, and I'll be interested to see what the Cabinet Secretary says in response to it. It was an amendment I was considering myself. There are issues about the presentation of invoices and the payment of rent, and there are circumstances in which presentation of invoices are not made, and this becomes a very confusing and difficult situation for tenants. there needs to be a renewed clarity about the exact process that would be followed in terms of irritancy. And I think that this amendment, although it is a notoriously difficult area and there may be some legal difficulties with this amendment, the spirit of this amendment is correct, that there must be a clarity for tenants. And perhaps if the legal issues are cloudy, some way could be found to helping Claudia Beamish to have an amendment at stage three, which would in actual fact improve this situation.
No other member wish to comment? Alec Ferguson.
Thank you, Convener. I'm not quite as supportive of this as is Mike Russell. Any lease of agricultural tenancy, any agricultural tenancy that I've ever come across, states very clearly when rent is due, usually Whitsun and Martinmas. And I really think that this is putting an unreasonable requirement to produce a piece of paper. We all know that there are a multitude of reasons why pieces of paper may not be received or delivered. And while I can understand Claudia Beamish's intention in this amendment, I think the practical difficulties of implementing it overcome its intention at this stage. I'm not inclined to support it. But.
Okay. Cabinet Secretary to respond.
Convener, Amendment 134 aims to provide protection to tenants of MLDTs by ensuring that a landlord cannot exercise the right to terminate the lease for non-payment of rent unless the tenant had first received an invoice prior to the rent due date and had then been given a reasonable time to pay the unpaid rent. Only if the tenant does not pay the rent could the landlord begin to exercise the right to end the lease. We do support the principle, but the bill already gives tenants in MLDTs the protection that Claudia Beamish, I believe, is looking for. Under our provisions in the new section 18A6, the landlord has to notify the tenant in writing that they haven't paid the rent, and the tenant then has at least 12 months to pay. The landlord can only irritate the lease if the tenant still hadn't paid after all that time. So we believe that amendment is not necessary. Amendment 275 is in two parts. The first part for 1991 Act tenancies duplicates the effect of what the 1991 Act already does. The existing process in Section 20 of that Act would already ensure the tenant is aware of how much rent is outstanding and has the chance to pay, and as such, we don't support this part of the amendment. However, I do support the second part of the amendment for short limited duration tenancies and limited duration tenancies in principle, and agree that it would be helpful, but it needs redrafting. For instance, the phrase reasonable opportunity is left undefined and that would have to be defined. I would invite Claudia Beamish to withdraw her amendment if she's willing to do that, and then we could work with her to bring forward appropriate amendments at stage three if we can do that. So I ask the committee to reject those amendments on that basis if Claudia Beamish is willing to work with us towards stage three.
So, Claudia Beamish, to wind up, press or withdraw?
I don't wish to say anything further. I think I will withdraw Amendment 134 because of what the Cabinet Secretary said. To be positive about it, I will try to fathom more of an understanding as to how that how what's in the bill already. And was it a previous act as well has given the protection that is needed for that one? So I will withdraw that. The second one, I would be very pleased to work with the Cabinet Secretary and officials on, and therefore also wish to withdraw 275.
So Claudia Beamish has sought to withdraw Amendment 134. And with the agreement of the committee. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? No member objects to the amendment being withdrawn. The question is that Section 78 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The conversion of 1991 Act tenancies and limited duration tenancies into modern limited duration tenancies. I call Amendment 157, in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with amendments 291, 158, 226, 228 and 259. I note that amendments 157 and 291 in this group are direct alternatives. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 157 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, as you know, we have planned for some time now to replace Section 79 of the Bill, which currently gives Minister a power to provide by regulations for secure 91 tenancies to be converted to MLDTs. There are two parts to the replacement of this section. One is the new resumption and assignation process, which Amendment 201 introduces, and we'll discuss that next week. The other is this amendment, which ensures that 1991 Act tenancies can still be converted to MLDTs by agreement, even though the original Section 79 is going to be removed from the Bill. Specifically, this amendment allows a landlord and a tenant to agree to convert a secure 1991 Act tenancy into an MLDT of at least 25 years. This is consistent with the existing arrangements in the 2003 Act, which state that when a 91 Act tenancy is converted to an LDT, that LDT must last for at least 25 years. Compensation is payable at the point the 91 Act tenancy converts to the MLDT. Again, this is consistent with the current arrangements for conversions to LDTs. The committee will wish to note that when a 91 Act tenancy converts to an MLDT, the new MLDT will not include the option of a break clause at the 5-year point. This is because the break clause is targeting new entrants, not established farmers like secure 91 tenants. As I have said, our Amendment 201 will introduce the other part of a replacement for Section 79, which is a new process that lets tenants relinquish their tenancies in exchange for compensation or assign them to a new or progressing farmer. We will be able to discuss these, as I said before, next week. But I'd like to take this opportunity to comment Alec Ferguson's alternative proposal for replacing Section 179, as set out in his Amendment 291, Section 79. The government's proposals have been carefully developed to ensure a fair balance between the rights and opportunities of tenants and landlords, set against the context of the wider public interest. By contrast, Alec Ferguson appears to be cherry-picking elements of the review groups and the government's former proposals in order to skew that balance as far as possible towards the interests of landlords. I know we're each accusing each other of cherry-picking, but I want to make a similar accusation. He has opted for a shorter MLDT term than the review group recommended, and he has given the landlord an automatic right to take back full control of the land in perpetuity for the same price as a new entrant would pay to have use of it for just 25 years. While I welcome that he's adopted an approach to targeting new entrants, the practical results of his proposals could be to keep down the price the landlords would have to pay ahead of genuinely increasing access to land for new farmers. Also, we do wonder what evidence Alec Ferguson has for choosing 25 years when the review group recommended that the converted lease should be a period of at least 35 years. And that view is shared by many key stakeholders. At each stage of process, he appears to have narrowed the review group's recommendations in the interest of the landlord without providing any counterbalance. We think that hardly is in the spirit of the review group's recommendations, and nor is it in the interest of the tenancy sector, as it doesn't provide the balance that current legislation and the Bill offer. I would therefore invite the committee to reject Amendment 291. In terms of consequentials, if Amendment 157 is accepted, then the power under Section 79(1) currently contains will be removed from the Bill, because Amendment 157 replaces the original Section 79 with full provisions for the conversion of 91 Acts to MLDTs. Amendment 226 therefore removes the reference to the Bill from the list of subordinate legislation at the end of the Bill. Again, in terms of consequential amendments, because it will no longer be possible for 91 Act tenancies to convert to LDTs, because they won't be there, there's no need for the notice to quit process in the 91 Act to be disapplied so as to allow speedy conversion to an LDT. But because Amendment 157 is effectively an updated version of Section 2, enabling 91 Act tenancies to convert to MLDTs instead of LDTs, the notice to quit process needs to be disapplied to allow speedy conversion to an MLDT. To be clear, existing LDTs will be able to continue. Alternatively, they will be able to convert to MLDTs under Amendment 158. This amendment allows them to convert without having to go through the length and expensive process of ending the LDTs and settling WAGO compensation and then beginning an MLDT from scratch. The minimum length of the new MLDTs will be however long the LDTs have left to run. So just to clarify, the minimum length of the new MLDTs will be however long the LDT has left to run. But parties will be free to set a longer duration if they so wish. The tenant's improvements will carry over into the MLDT so that the tenant receives compensation. The tenant is entitled to when that MLDT ends. And finally, another consequential issue is that the legal definition of a limited duration tenancy in the 2003 Act is set out in Section 93 of the Act and defined by reference to Section 5 of the 2003 Act. However, the bill repeals Section 5 of the 2003 Act as part of replacing LDTs with MLDTs. Because pre-existing LDTs may continue for many years, we therefore need to include a workable definition of LDTs in Section 93 of the 2003 Act, which this amendment does. So I move Amendment 157.
Thank you. I call Alec Ferguson to speak to Amendment 291.
Thank you, Convener. And while I do accept that Amendments 157 and 291 are direct alternatives, I think there is a difference because the Cabinet Secretary moves 157 as part of a suite of alternatives, some of which we will be debating next week, whereas I table mine not as an alternative, but as a replacement for Section 79, for reasons that I will elaborate on. I've tabled Amendment 291 to replace Section 79 as currently drafted and to replace it with a new section giving greater clarity and detail of the conversion model. And I do so because I believe that the conversion model holds the key to the improvement in landlord-tenant relationships that I would hope we're all seeking to bring about through this legislation. And what I can say with absolute certainty is that the government's belated proposals on relinquishment and assignation as part of the options that are going to be available will, if anything, cause even greater tensions within the relationship, and with that, the opposite effect on the future availability of land for rent that is one of the stated intentions of the bill. Now, members might well not be surprised at Scottish Land and Estates' opposition to that proposal, but I would hope they are somewhat surprised by the NFU's opposition, on agricultural grounds certainly, because theirs is not the opposition of landlords and their agents. It is the view mostly of owner-occupiers and small landowners who see a very real threat in what the government is proposing. Now, unlike assignation, whether or not it is preceded by an offer to relinquish a lease, conversion to an MLDT can and does, I believe, meet the policy objectives of this legislation and let the sector move forward on a positive footing. That was also the view of the Agricultural Holdings Legislation Review Group, which I've said before was chaired by the Cabinet Secretary, and it was also supported by the committee in its Stage 1 report. A conversion model would provide tenants with an option to retire while sending a positive message to the industry about fixed-term tenancies. In cases where conversions did take place, while in many cases the owner of the land's expectation of regaining vacant possession of the holding would be delayed for a significant period of time, and I'm absolutely open to discussion on that length of that period, the owner of that land would at least have the prospect of regaining possession in future to be able then to either re-let it or to reorganise either the landlord or or other tenants' farming businesses. It would introduce a measure of flexibility. What assignation for value, that model, ring-fences the secure tenancy, and the owner of the land would have little prospect of ever regaining possession unless he could afford to exercise his right to buy the tenant's interests by effectively paying a premium for his own property. The conversion to MLDT model, therefore, is a less severe breach of a landlord's property rights. Now, I think that is important because the less severe any breach of an owner of land's property rights, the more likely the owner of that land is going to make it available for rent. Section 79, as currently drafted in the bill, was heavily criticised for the reliance on secondary legislation. My Amendment 291 inserts a new Section 29 based on the existing provision, but adds further detail about what conversion to an MLDT would involve, including measures that would provide, firstly, that the landlord would be required to match the sum being offered by the prospective assignee, which means that the landlord has a true right of preemption while not being required to pay a premium. Secondly, that the potential assignees are limited to new entrants and farmers wishing to progress in the industry, which surely means that the provisions are aimed not only at assisting people to exit the sector which is a problem at the moment, but also providing opportunities for those wishing to enter it. That's not skewing the legislation in favour of the landlord. I think it's rather the opposite. And finally, this can, I believe, and does meet the Scottish Government's policy objectives in a balanced and proportionate manner. The problem I have is that my amendment it really needs to be debated alongside 201, which we're not going to be debated till next week. But I will listen to what the Minister has to say and other members in this debate before deciding whether to press my amendment or not. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Any other members wish to comment on this? No? Okay, let's move straight to the Cabinet Secretary to wind up.
I do respect Alec Ferguson's views on these matters, and I outlined in my own remarks the Government's position, and we clearly disagree with his amendment. In terms of the NFU's position, I know we've had further representations from some members of the NFU today who do support the Government's approach to this issue. In terms of Alec Ferguson's comment over a guarantee of regaining, as he put it, his secure property rights for landowners. At the moment, of course, there is no such guarantee in any case, because if a secure tenant has a successor in place, it will continue to be a tenant on the land, and that secure tenancy will continue if there's a successor. So that guarantee is not there that I think Alec Ferguson's chasing in any case. And clearly Alec Ferguson's approach is to revert to closer to the original proposal that we are now replacing with two further measures, one of which is discussed this week, one of which is discussed next week, in terms of assignation of 91 tenancies, which we believe will help keep land in the tenancy sector, which is the ultimate aim of this measure, because if a tenant, secure tenant, does not have a successor, then that land could be lost to the tenancy sector, and the Government's approach now will help keep that land in the tenancy sector, and that's the ultimate aim we're trying to achieve.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 157 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. Those in favour of 157, please show. Hands down. Those against? Those in favour... Sorry, I beg your pardon. Those against, once again? It's two. So it's seven. So 7 for, 2 against and no abstain. So Amendment 157 is agreed. I call Amendment 291 in the name of Alec Ferguson. Are you debated with Amendment 157? Alec Ferguson to move or not move?
I think at this stage I won't move, Convener, and we'll come back to it at a later stage.
Okay. In that case, we move on to... question is that Section 79 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're agreed. Call Amendments 158, 159, 160, 161, 162, 163, 164 and 165, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated. Invite the Cabinet Secretary to move these amendments 158 to 165 en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Ask whether any member objects a single question being put on the amendments 159 to 165. 159. It was correct in my notes here. Does any member object to the question being put? If no member objects, the question is that amendments 159 to 165 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. So this is 292. Yeah. So Act 1991 Act Tenancies, Tenants' Right to Buy, where interposed lease. Call Amendment 292. In the name of Michael Russell, in a group of its own, Mike Russell, to move and speak to Amendment 292.
Thank you, Convener. I won't be very lengthy on this because I want to say a word or two more in the next section about some of the history of land reform in Scotland. But there is an anomaly within the situation that those tenants who have 1991 Act tenancies who have interposed leases cannot exercise a right to buy. This is an interposed lease, is a lease that is put in place between the landlord and the tenant. Now, there can be legitimate reasons for interposed leases, and they are obviously used from time to time for those legitimate reasons. But there can also be landlords who use interposed leases to avoid the right to buy. And that is extremely unfair, but is now presently possible. An interposed lease can be put in place without the consent of the tenant, and that is a result of the Land Tenure Reform Act of 1974, as a result of which there are tenants who simply will be unable forever to exercise a right to buy which otherwise might have occurred for circumstances in this Act. And this is clearly a frustration of the intention of the government, but it's also a frustration of the tenant's legitimate rights and expectations. So I'm seeking to ensure that that anomaly is removed, that that injustice to those tenants is removed, and that progress is made to ensure the tenants who have interposed leases can exercise their right to buy.
Thank you. Any members to comment?
No.
If not, Cabinet Secretary to respond.
Can I say to Michael Russell and the committee that I'm very sympathetic to the position of tenants who, without any say in the matter, have ended up as subtenants in interposed leases, and therefore, as Michael Russell says, don't qualify for the preemptive right to buy. Well, there may well be some legitimate reasons that a landlord might interpose a lease. It isn't right that interposing should be used as a means of denying tenants the right to buy, as Michael Russell says. This is an issue we have been looking at following the review group's recommendation on right to buy for tenants and interposed leases. It's a complex area and considerable work will be needed to find a solution that's both fair and, of course, legal. So it isn't something we could include in the bill at this time. Under this amendment, the subtenant would buy the land, but the land would still be subject to a head lease with a tenant, and that tenant is controlled by the original landlord. So if a subtenant does exercise the right to buy, they won't be able to farm the land because the landlord's interposed tenant is still there and has the right to farm the land. Once the dust settles, all a subtenant achieves potentially is that they are now the landlord, and the landlord is now the tenant. And there's nothing to stop that tenant from using the right to buy, which means it could end up with the original subtenant having no land at all. So it is a very complex area and, you know, quite confusing. So we do need time to resolve these quite difficult questions, like whether to let the subtenant buy the tenant's interest as well as the land, and whether that might make it so expensive that nobody would want to do it in the first place. So again, I'm very sympathetic to this issue. Of course, it's a complex matter. We need to undertake a full assessment of all the issues that arise from this. But I am happy to go on record and say to Michael Russell and the committee that accordingly we do plan a consultation on this for early in the next parliamentary term, and that will enable us to properly assess the situation and address it in a way that works. In the meantime, I would urge Michael Russell to withdraw this particular amendment.
So, Mike Russell, to wind up, press or withdraw?
Yes, there are a number of issues that are arising in this bill which indicate that it will require to be further action taken. This is one anomaly. I'm going to refer to some later on. I do think it's a pity that these were not considered as the process of this drawing bill went forward, but I do accept that it's not a matter that can be resolved in a few weeks. So with the Cabinet Secretary's commitment that there is a desire to solve this, with a timescale now mentioned, which is early in the next Parliament, I would hope, whoever is in government, then I will be prepared not to move this, but on the understanding that it does get resolved and it gets resolved in the next session of the Parliament.
Thank you. Mike Russell has sought to withdraw Amendment 292 with the agreement of the committee. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? No member objects to the question being withdrawn. The question is that Section 80 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. 1991 Act Tenancies, absolute right to buy for certain tenants. I call Amendment 293 in the name of Michael Russell, group with Amendments 293A and 293B. Mike Russell to move Amendment 293 and speak to all the amendments in the group.
I'm conscious, Convener, that on the Deer Management amendments, I started my contribution in the 19th century. I want to do the same again in this section because much of what we deal with in Scotland on issues of land and land law has its roots in the failure to change in Scotland at a time when others were changing. It's instructive that in a period of 40 years in Ireland, There were four significant land reform acts, 1870, 1881, 1903 and 1909. Now, they arose out of very different political circumstances. But what they did was to ensure that systems of tenancy, which we still have, do not exist there. And indeed, if you look at the history of land reform throughout Europe and further afield, much action was taken in the 19th and earliest 20th century to recognise the rights of those who work upon the land and who have worked land for a considerable period of time. No such, or virtually no such, changes took place in Scotland. Certainly there was a progress of land reform that the UK Parliament legislated for, an ambitious land reform act like the changes to agricultural tenancies in the 1940s, 1948 Act in particular. But in Scotland, the process of considering the way the land was used, the relationship of people to land, and the use of land as a resource, particularly a community resource, has been slow in coming. And it's only with this establishment of this Parliament in 1999 that the process essentially began to move into something other than a crawling gear. And now we are having to cope with those changes, because the changes in land reform, the need in land reform, has to take account, for example, of the ECHR, which is hardwired into the DNA of this Parliament, and necessarily so. The ECHR is a very important part of considering how people should be treated. But it's actually much harder to reform the tenure of land with the ECHR in place, unless you accept, and this is a process we've been engaged in this bill, and I think it's been a very instructive and useful process, unless you accept that there are a variety of rights that people have, and that those rights are not defined in a single European convention, no matter how important, but are defined much more widely on the international scene. And this bill, hopefully to become an act before the end of this Parliament, this bill will take that understanding of the balance of rights and responsibilities a big step forward. As it does so, it will need to consider some very problematic issues, such as the right to buy. Now, I'm not suggesting an unconditional right to buy, and I want to make that absolutely clear. This is not an absolute right to buy. But there are many circumstances in which conditional rights to buy are not yet dealt with in legislation, which need to be dealt with. And I've brought this amendment because I am concerned that there has been a consistent attempt to close this issue down, to say that this is not, there is no demand for this, there is no need for it. And I notice in the lobbying that we've had around this bill that has been a consistent theme, and that it therefore should be put away, not just for discussion, but forever. Because that's what we're receiving from people. This must not be talked about. It is a reform that dare not speak its name. But it's not a particularly radical reform. And the illustration of that is in this amendment. What this amendment actually suggests is very modest indeed. It's not expropriation of land. It is establishing a right to buy for those people who have been working that particular piece of land for half a century. Those are the people who have put in their effort, their time, very often their investment, into improving and developing a farm. And all it does is establishes a right to buy in those circumstances. Now, you can define three groups of people about how they look at this legislation, this piece of legislation. There are those who believe that in actual fact such things are no longer relevant, that there is a healthy relationship between landlords and tenants and that people should get on with it. And I'm not averse to that. There are many circumstances in which that is true, and I'm certainly not criticising every single landlord. There are those who believe that the rights to property are absolute and can never be interfered with, and in those circumstances any such amendment cannot be considered, and that's simply not true. The legislation that Scottish Parliament has passed, not just under this government but under previous administration, shows that that is not true. And there are those who have, in their own circumstances, a real need for change. And I represent some of those people who have a real need for change and who believe that it would be far better if they were able to purchase their land and to move ahead to use it. And indeed, I had a conversation this morning with somebody about that, who said to me, surely there is no evidence that those who wish to buy their farms are going to be better than those better farmers than being tenants. And I can go to many places in my constituency and prove exactly that. Those people have taken that opportunity, have been able to do things that they could only dream of when they were in tenancies that were not working for them. So I want to take this issue forward, but I recognise that ECHR does change that context. And therefore, I don't expect that this amendment will succeed on this occasion. But I want to have ventilated the issue. I want to make it clear that the issue is not over. It is not closed down. And this is one of those issues, like interposed leases, to which we will have to return. And I want there to be a debate about those rights that tenants have within the context not just of ECHR, but in the context of a much wider view of rights, and in the context of those who have worked the land and are passionately devoted to that land. Because I did see some references at the weekend when this was being discussed to people who simply said, well, if people want to go buy a farm, they can go and buy a farm somewhere else. That is not the issue. If you live on the island of Islay, if you live on the island of Bute, if you have long-term family connections for generations to a community, then I think you do have a right to move forward in that community, having proved your ability, your worth, and your involvement and investment in that community. I do not regard this as in any sense a radical move. I regard it as a necessary next step. And although that step won't be taken in this legislation, I hope that the Minister will recognise that the Land Commission will have to consider this, there will need to be a continued extension of the right to buy, and that does not destabilise the agricultural market. What it does is it recognises the modern reality, which we should have recognised during the 19th and 20th century in Scotland, but unfortunately we did not have a parliament to do so.
And are you going to move?
I will move this amendment at this stage. I mean, I may withdraw it when we come to the vote, because I want to hear what the Minister has to say.
And Claudia Beamish to move Amendment 293A and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener, and I do indeed move Amendment 293A. And I want to speak in support of what Mike Russell has said. I think it is very important that we acknowledge that those who've worked the land over generations, and 50 years is a good marker in my view, do have rights, and that it's not only about the ECHR rights, but it's about other rights that need to be recognised and respect shown to those who have worked the land in a more sort of ethical sense rather than the actual statutory sense. My amendments to Mike Russell's amendment are to sort of try to help by limiting the right to buy in a way that might give reassurance to some who are opposed to it. And I listened very carefully to what Mike Russell said and suspect that this won't be the time when these things go forward, but they aren't things that can be avoided and brushed under the carpet. They're issues that we must, I believe, face in modern Scotland. And there is a demand for this to be looked at. The STFA survey recently showed that 85% support for a qualified or limited right to buy. And I understand that the Scottish Government's own survey showed a 46% support for absolute right to buy and a 29% support for a conditional right to buy. My amendment does suggest a limited period in which tenants can issue a notice under Section 38B1. The amendment suggests 5 years from the date that this bill becomes an act. And as I've said, I think this might give some confidence about letting for landowners, but also give those in secure tenancies an opportunity to purchase their land, which I believe is the right way forward. Although I haven't put these points into my amendment, there's also the possibility in relation to this, which I think might be helpful at this stage to put on the record, that there might also be a clause, as this is considered, whereby the tenant could buy the farm if the landlord was in breach within this section, and it might also be that amendment could be considered in a state of optimism. I've written here at stage three, but I'm not quite sure that's going to be the case. But where a successor had to be named, that's another issue to look at, preventing a situation where a tenant could purchase the farm at a very reasonable price and then possibly sell it on quickly on the open market. There might also be a connected resale clause to prevent an unfair profit being possible. So I do think that that not an absolute right to buy, but a limited or qualified or conditional right to buy, however one wanted to phrase it, is something that we really do have to consider very seriously. And I am frankly disappointed that we've, in my view, that some people have shied away from addressing it. And I would have liked to have seen it moving forward towards stage three, having had a debate at stage two. But I'll leave it at that for the moment.
I want to bring in some other members now. I've had indications from Dave Thompson first and Graham Day. Dave.
Thank you very much, Convener. This is a subject which is fairly dear to my own heart. I remember when I was first selected in 2002 to stand in Rosskye and Inverness West. I went along to a meeting in the Tower Hotel, which was one of the founding meetings, if not the founding meeting, of the Scottish Tenant Farmers Association. And I then put forward a motion to the SNP conference that year advocating a right to buy, which the conference approved, by the way. That's 14 years ago, and here we are still talking about these things. Now, the big problem and the big issue, and Mike Russell alluded to it when he was speaking, is to do with ECHR. The ECHR, which is written into the Scotland Act, which set up this Parliament, very much ties the hands of the Parliament, because there's a difference between legislation having to be ECHR compliant, which is a matter of opinion untested in the courts, and for people being able to challenge legislation under ECHR. And they're two quite different things. So I think there's a wider issue here which isn't going to be dealt with here today, and that is that the fact that it's written into the Scotland Act needs to be looked at, and it needs to be removed so we have the same freedom of putting forward legislation as any other legislature, legislation which can still be challenged under ECHR as say, UK legislation would be in the European Court. Now, having said that, Scottish Tenant Farmers Association wrote to us just yesterday, and they indicated that their support basically for a conditional right to buy, and Mike Russell's condition is 50 years. And I'll be interested to hear what the Cabinet Secretary does have to say when he responds. But there are various conditions that they are suggesting could be applied to a right to buy to try to ensure fairness for everybody. Things such as the tenant demonstrating greater investment in the holding than the landlord during the term of the tenancy, evidence of the landlord being in breach of obligations or farming business being inhibited by the scale of land ownership or the actions of a landowner, demonstration of eligible succession, so a landlord would not have an expectation of vacant possession in the near future, clawback in the event of resale within, say, 10 years, and a landlord's right of preemption if the farm was sold within 10 years. And I would hope that all of these sort of things, along with those mentioned by Mike Russell and Claudia Beamish, would be the sort of things that would go into the pot and into the debate when this is considered in future. And I think it must be considered in the next Parliament. It must be considered early. It's a boil that's been festering for many, many years now. It's souring relationships between landlords and tenants. We need to deal with it. We need to lance it. And the only way to do that is to bring in a form of conditional right to buy along the lines that we've heard being discussed this morning. Thank you.
Thank you. Graham Day.
Thank you, Convener. Can I begin by commending Mike Russell for bringing forward his amendment? And my knowledge and understanding, such as it is, of the realities of tenancies is far more recent than that of Mr. Russell's or indeed Dave Thompson and others. But the more I learn about the tenancy issue, the more I'm inclined towards enhancing right to buy provisions in certain circumstances. And I, I would contend that in that regard, Mr. Russell's amendment should not readily be dismissed, although I can't help but wonder, convener, whether it would be best sat in amongst a broader package which Parliament and stakeholders had an opportunity to work through, hopefully with constructive intent, because I think we're all of us only too well aware of the consequences, indeed the painful consequences for some which can arise from passing legislation which is subsequently deemed to be flawed. The principles behind Claudia Beamish's amendment could also be considered, I think, in that setting, although like Mike Russell's, it would have ECHR hurdles to overcome, and indeed I think potentially could be subject to challenge by both tenants and landlords. But I look forward to hearing from the Cabinet Secretary in his response, which I hope will recognise that the debate that Mr Russell so eloquently has called for is one that we do need to have in the near future.
Alec Ferguson.
Thank you. This with considerable interest. Mike Russell described three categories of people when it came to right to buy, and I don't really recognise myself in any of them, to be perfectly honest. It's probably a good job I'm retiring in 6 or 7 weeks' time, because I'm quite clear that this is going to come back in the next Parliament. And if I may say so, I think that is the right place for it if this debate has to take place, because I would have been very, very concerned, and I will be very concerned, if Mike Russell's amendment is agreed today, because if the government's amendments on assignation are likely to end up in the courts, as I believe they will be, and maybe others who disagree with that, then Mike Russell's amendment, if agreed, would absolutely guarantee it. What I'm not going to deny at all is that this is going to be a continuing debate. I think that is quite clear. But it is a debate that needs the fullness of time if it is not going to have those who own land and have that land available to let at the moment, if they are not going to put up the shutters on letting that land and do everything they can to prevent that land being let. Because if this is rushed into, if it is done in a top-down bullying sort of way, then that will be the result. And if we want a truly invigorated tenancy sector, then we have to try and take as many people with us as we possibly can. I think some members have difficulty believing that I have the interests of the tenanted sector at heart, but I do. I want to see a tenanted sector that is really vibrant and open and modern and dynamic as much as the next person. I'm very worried that this legislation as it stands is not going to help achieve that, but I'm absolutely convinced that Mike Russell's amendment, which with respect is an absolute right to buy, albeit under some constraints, but it is an absolute right to buy. That of itself will have a hugely negative impact. Given 5 years of debate, which I hope would be very inclusive debate of all parties involved, then there is possibly a solution at the end of the day. But it is, as I say, I don't believe it is for this bill or for this Parliament to determine, and I hope that that debate will be left for future years.
Any other member wish to speak? Then I intend to make a few remarks on this. I'd like to set it in the context of the fact that we have briefings from Scottish Land and Estates, and the President of the National Farmers Union, Alan Bowie, talking about, in the case of SLE, we believe that the introduction of this right to buy would not be in the long term serve the industry. And Alan Bowie saying, from an agricultural industry perspective, there appears little justification for an absolute right to buy. That's an interesting concept, because I think it sets the idea of farming as an industry. Indeed, probably from the point of view, as the way Pete Hetherington summed it up, it is about property development. Whereas in the circumstances of the time that it's taken for people to find security, it's surprising over the piece how long many people have had to take. I want to take you back into the 19th century as well. I want to take you back to the time of the Crofters Commission report, when John McPherson, the Glendale martyr, told the Crofters Commission in the 1880s, he told them that our forefathers had died in good patience, and that we ourselves have been waiting in good patience till now,
and that we could not wait any longer. That they never got anything by their patience, but constantly getting worse. In 1907, the articles were created for the tenants of Glendale to be able to buy their holdings by a Conservative government. We are looking at the need for security for tenants today. We note that 120 secure tenancies are being lost every year. We're in a position not to agree, I think, that the idea is that it's about an agricultural industry, but indeed it's about people living and farming the land. And when the NFU president goes on to say it's clear that many of the calls are coming from a wider land reformist perspective rather than an agricultural one, then I question, what is agriculture for? And I have done so in the Parliament before, and I believe that that question has to be applied to this particular amendment. I've got a lot of sympathy with what Mike Russell has said. I believe that the Cabinet Secretary has to take these things into account, given the historic precedent of the time that has taken for people to secure security in the past, and indeed for the time that it's taken for the address of this very limited condition where tenants have been tenants for over 50 years. I look forward to what the Cabinet Secretary has to say. Yes.
Well, I'm sorry you're so reluctant about it, because this is, I think we would all agree, a hugely important debate. And I hear what the convener says, and I can understand it if I don't fully agree with it. But I think he quoted the NFUS and SLE's briefings, and you may well argue they have axes to grind. But I don't think they have the same axe to grind as the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors. And I really don't think that. Yes, they have a vested interest, of course they do, but I think it's a different one. And this is also about, this whole bill is also about creating a viable and active tenanted sector. And a briefing report by the Chartered Surveyors a couple of years ago now set out that the introduction of an absolute right to buy would increase the cost of purchasing farms, it would decrease the quality of farms available to rent, and that it would decrease the number of farms, and it would decrease the, not just the quality, but also the number of farms to rent. And I do think we have to bear that sort of thing in mind as we go forward, because if we want to create that tenanted sector of vibrancy, we have to take these things into account. Now, I'm not saying they're right or wrong, but I do think that underlines the argument that a considerable time needs to be taken over this debate going forward. I'm beginning to be sorry I'm not going to be part of that debate now, because it's going to be a good one. It's going to be a good one. But there are not black and white issues here, is what I'm trying to say, and I hope people will bear that in mind as this debate goes forward in future years.
Sarah Boyack.
Just a brief, convener, in response to the comments that Alex Ferguson has just made there. My understanding is that these amendments aren't about an absolute right to buy. They're about a limited right to buy in quite clearly stated circumstances. And that is the debate we need to be having here. Is the balance right at the moment? I've read all the briefings that colleagues will have read about the need for balance and the need for fairness. And I think the point I would come at is that we don't have that balance at the right place at the moment. So that's what I think these amendments are testing. And there is a difficulty about doing all of this in a stage two or a stage three. But this clearly is part of the backdrop to whether this bill is going to be successful, is where that balance and where that fairness lies. So I think this is an important debate. And I think the amendments that have been put forward are amendments that are designed not as extreme amendments, but as shifting that balance. And they are quite proportionate, I think, in the way they've been put forward. So I think that's the spirit in which we should have this debate. And I hope that will be the way it's viewed outside of this chamber as well, that this is as part of a context, both of land reform and also of how land is used in Scotland. And then fairness to the people that farm that land, that look after that land, and that invest in that land, And when we think about the debates we've had over the last few months about what's happening in the dairy industry, delays in cap payments, it really is a tough time. And for all those involved in that process, the finances are key, but so is the place from where people are starting from. And I think some of the amendments will come to later on about how agricultural holdings actually operate. I think these are key. So I think it's wrong to dismiss these amendments as being amendments that will completely rewrite the process. It is what's being suggested is a shift in the balance, and I think that shift is a legitimate shift for us to be debating today.
Well, I won't come back in any way at the moment, but I think we should hear from the Cabinet Secretary before we come back to Mike Russell. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. I've listened very carefully to the very eloquent contributions from many members on the committee, and in most cases there's not a lot I disagree with that's been expressed by members. Can I say at the outset I understand the reasons why Michael Russell has brought forward this amendment, particularly in light of the circumstances and well-documented cases in his own constituency and indeed in other constituencies in Scotland. However, the Agricultural Holdings Review Group considered the issue of the right to buy and the circumstances under which it should apply very carefully and was, of course, one of many bodies to reject the absolute right to buy as not focusing on agricultural contribution and creating a vibrant Tennessee sector. It also, like many members around the table today, recognised that this area of law and its interaction with ECHR is a legal minefield. This committee has rightly emphasised that it's essential the provisions in the bill comply with ECHR, and we're all acutely aware of the importance of avoiding another Salveson versus Riddle situation, a point that was well made by the committee in your own Stage 1 report. Our view is that this amendment breaches ECHR and is out with the competence of the Parliament. However, I do recognise that there is a widespread belief that a conditional right to buy would be beneficial, and that is what Scottish Government has already begun to establish in this bill. For example, this bill creates opportunities for tenants to order the sale of and then buy their holdings when the landlord is in breach of his or her obligations. Indeed, I think that addresses some of the points that the STFA made, which were reiterated by Dave Thompson. It also gives communities a right to buy local land when sustainable development is at risk as well, and in some of those cases that should involve tenanted farms. I therefore hope that Michael Russell will withdraw this amendment, but I am also mindful of the fact that this is not and by any means a static situation. This debate has certainly moved on over the past few years, and as land reform progresses in Scotland, there will be opportunities to consider whether further change is necessary and can contribute to community well-being, agricultural progress and the sustainability of rural businesses and rural communities. And I know and I believe anybody in my position will keep that under review, just as I'm sure that a number of MSPs will want to continue to press for further change. I have no doubt that the Land Commission, once established, will be very mindful of this ongoing debate in Scotland and the entirely legitimate desire for tenants to have more of a say over their own destiny. Indeed, in light of the well-known cases in Argyll in particular, including those involving constituents who Michael Russell's introduced to me and I've met personally, and other cases again elsewhere in the country, I absolutely agree that it is vital that the next Parliament does review to what extent the bill has been able to deliver for such cases and to look at the issues around a conditional right to buy. So in that context, and the overriding context of land reform is now an ongoing process in Scotland and this Parliament, I hope that outlines the Government's position.
Okay, I call Mike Russell to wind up, and then it will be Claudia Beamish to wind up, and her amendment comes first.
Thank you, Convener. There will be people who have listened to this debate or who are expected to listen to this debate with a sense of disappointment, and I don't think they should feel disappointed. I've been very impressed by the very high quality of the debate on every side, and I think it's been a very serious and well-informed debate. And I want to say at the very outset, I think there is a fourth category I would put Alec Ferguson into. I'll have to create that category. There is a category of somebody who is immensely knowledgeable about this, who is very passionate about it, who has an open mind about some of those issues, but also has reservations because of the fears that this will impact adversely upon the agricultural sector. And I fully understand that. And that's one of the reasons why we have to bring this back in order to examine it properly. And I'll do that in a moment. And I'll explain how I think that should happen in a moment. But we need to be very careful, of course, that we don't get this wrong. The spectre of Salvis and Riddle has been raised around this table, and it's right to raise it. Because that has resulted, not because it's a problem for the Parliament, although it is, it's resulted in real suffering for individuals. And this committee has discussed that on a number of occasions. And I don't want to be involved in anything that creates circumstances where individuals suffer as a result of it. So that's a strong reason for me to say, OK, I want this now, but let's spend some time on it. But I want to say to the Cabinet Secretary too, because repeatedly we've heard in this bill from ministers, and I understand why, I've been a minister myself, bills must be watertight. Well, that's true. But I want to say to the Cabinet Secretary that sometimes the right position for a government is to be in the courts, defending the decisions it has made as right decisions. And simply to avoid going into the courts is not enough of a justification not to do something. Because if we accept legal threat as the means by which we will always avoid things, we'll make no progress. So while I think we should avoid the Salvis and Riddle difficulties, the difficulties that undoubtedly are in this amendment, because this amendment is drawn up with the tremendous help of the parliamentary clerks, but it's not been drawn up with the help of the Scottish Government's legal side and experienced parliamentary draftsmen who have done this for years. But in order to avoid that, we probably need to do some more work. But in the end, we may have to defend this and this right thing to do against those who wish to undermine it. So the legal issues persuade me that we should not proceed with this at this stage. The debate encourages me greatly, and I want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response, because this debate has indicated right around this table, even if you disagree with this, that this is not a dead issue. It's not done and dusted. Now, what the Land Reform Review Group said was not the final word on this, and there will have to be progress on the issue of a conditional right to buy. And this is a conditional right to buy. It's not an absolute right to buy, but it's a conditional right to buy. And if we take this forward, then how do we take it forward? And I just want to make one suggestion, Convener. I will not press this amendment at this stage, but I do think that at the very early days of the next Parliament, there should be consideration given as to how you manage to implement this. Now, it's possible that could be done by a very simple bill. One of the problems of agricultural tenancy and agricultural holdings legislation is it's immensely complicated. As the Cabinet Secretary said before, you change one thing and another thing falls out the end. It might be possible to be much more simple about this, but whatever is done, it should be well prepared. And I would hope there would be a constructive national debate on it, and I hope people would realise that this is a necessary step forward, but we also need to think about it. And I will certainly go away from this debate thinking about it, because I profoundly believe it is the right thing to do, and it is not a threat. It is, in actual fact, the fulfilment of the next stage of enabling the people who are engaged in Scottish agriculture to do their very best and to benefit themselves and their communities. And I think that's what we should all have ambition for. So I won't press this. I'm grateful for the debate. We've moved a step on, not as far as I want to go by any manner of means, but we are still moving, and that's important.
Thank you. Claudia Beamish to wind up on Amendment 293A and press or withdraw.
Right, thank you, Convener. My amendment was an attempt to find a balance whereby there would be confidence from landowners and landlords, and I so often have heard this argument put forward that people won't want to let land if there's any form of right to buy. And I think even the confusion within this debate today has shown that we really need to be clear about what we're talking about. We're not talking, as I understand it, about an absolute right to buy. We're talking about a qualified or conditional or limited right to buy, depending on the phrase that one's looking at. And I think that It is really, really important that this comes back. As someone who is reasonably new to this debate, but like all of us here, has a sense of fairness and justice, I'm puzzled why it sort of seems to have been kicked again into the long grass, and I find that disappointing. And I think there are those of us who will certainly want to take the debate forward if we're back in the next Parliament, and I'm sure there'll be others who will want to if we're not. And on that basis, I withdraw my amendments, though. I think the words of Mike Russell and Dave Thompson and Rob Gibson have been very important in this, as has the shorter contribution of my colleague Sarah Boyack.
Claudia Beamish has sought to withdraw Amendment 293A with the agreement of the committee. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? Nobody objects. So we call Amendment 293B in the name of Claudia Beamish, already debated with Amendment 293. Claudia Beamish, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. The question is that amendment. Yeah, you need to, the question is Amendment 293 be agreed to, but are you going to withdraw it or?
Not moved at this stage.
No.
But I'll be back at some stage.
Does anybody object to this Amendment 293 being withdrawn at this stage? Nobody objects at this stage. Right, we'll take a very short 5-minute break. And we'll try and go until 1:20, and then we will try and finish our report. So we're going to have a 5-minute break just now. Michael Russell, Group with Amendment 295. Mike Russell, to move Amendment 294 and speak to both amendments in the group.
The question I'm raising is simply whether there are circumstances in this bill where a tenant will get to the stage of purchase without actually knowing exactly where he or she is in terms of the purchase price. That's issue number one. The second issue is simply to ensure that the clawback process is better and more comprehensive, I have to say, than the clawback process that was in the original bill. Clawback is always going to be controversial and difficult, but I think it is one of those areas where you need the absolute clarity within the bill of how this was absolutely to work. And the specific amendment that I'm proposing at 167, in actual fact, makes sure that if there is clawback after difficulties with a tenancy, the landlord who is in breach should not profit as a result of investment or action taken by the tenant. And I think that's a basic principle, that those who are at fault should not profit. So both of these are simple and clear. I'd be quite happy to discover that I am wrong in terms of the price issue, in which case we need proceed no further. I hope, however, the Cabinet Secretary will be more sympathetic to the issue, the principle behind Amendment 167, because it is important that those who have behaved badly don't profit as a result of that behaviour.
Thank you. So Claudia Beamish to speak to Amendment 295 and other amendment in the group.
Right, thank you, Convener. I'd like to speak in favour of Mike Russell's amendment, and I think it's important that in this group, the point being that it refers to a scenario where the landlord is forced to sell the land due to a material breach of the obligations in relation to the tenant. Some tenants have advised me they can become committed to the sale before the price has been determined, and that this is a pressure that they don't want to be subjected to, of course. It's a scenario where nobody looking to buy a property would normally agree to. Therefore, my amendment gives the tenant the option to withdraw from the sale for up to 28 days after the price is known. I believe this is a reasonable and fair time for consideration. On the 28 days to withdraw under Section 38F, the amendment is written on the basis that the tenant would have 28 days after learning the price to withdraw from the offer. However, my own understanding would be that the offer would not need to be made until the price was known. If the price was then not to the tenant's liking, the tenant can give notice under Section 38E, saying that they no longer intend to proceed under Section 38F. I hope I've got that right. And do I move the amendment in my name or not yet?
Not yet, no. Do any other members wish to comment on this matter? No. In that case, Cabinet Secretary to respond.
Can I say I'm grateful to Michael Russell and Claudia Beamish for highlighting the importance of making sure a tenant doesn't have to commit to buy the land before they know the price of the land and what that will be. And I'm happy to go on the record to say that I can confirm that as currently drafted, the bill already gives that protection. If the tenant decides to buy, they make an offer under subsection 38F1, and that offer must be at the price arrived at under 38F2. So the tenant cannot make an offer under 38F1 until they already know the price. Once the tenant has found out the price, they are under no obligation to buy. If they decide they don't want to buy, they need to give notice of that under 38EF. But the tenant will never be able to, will never find themselves in the position of having to sign a blank cheque. So the order of events that Michael Russell is looking to make clear is the order already prescribed by the bill. The amendment, I would argue, is therefore unnecessary, but I'd be happy to look at whether the explanatory notes to the bill can be updated and improved to make sure the position is unambiguous. And if other guidance is required to be published, we'd make sure that would happen as well. Claudia Beamish's amendment could actually confuse matters, if she doesn't mind me saying so, because a tenant can't make an offer until they know the price. Her amendment would mean that a tenant could find out the price, make an offer at that price, but then withdraw the offer, which wouldn't help the interests of any of the parties involved in the sale. And of course, there's already provisions in the bill that mean that the offer can't be made until the tenant knows the price. So I would urge the members to withdraw the amendments in light of my comments.
In that case, Mike Russell to wind up.
I'm pleased that my amendment 294 is not necessary, and in those circumstances I won't press it. It was important to have that clarified. It's on the record, and if we can have also clarity, better clarity in the guidelines, then we won't get into that trouble.
Thank you. Mike Russell is seeking to withdraw amendment 294 with the agreement of the committee. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? No one objects. In that case, I call amendment 295 in the name of Claudia Beamish, already debated with amendment 294. Claudia Beamish, to move or not move?
Move, and apologies for any confusion. I was trying to make for more clarity rather than confusion.
You're going to move it?
No, sorry, not moved. Obviously, right. Need to okay. Take a break.
Thank you. Right, we call agricultural holdings minor and consequential. Call Amendment 166 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with Amendments 203, 205, 208, 206, 207, 212, 251, 263, 264 and 265. These amendments 263 and 264 in this group are preempted by the Amendment 300 in the group retention of existing procedures for variation or review of rent. Cabinet Secretary, to move the amendment and speak to all the amendments in the group.
Okay, I'll take the guidance of you, Convener, if you wish me to speak to all these amendments, which are minor and consequential ones, or move on block.
Possibly get to that stage of moving them on block, if you can explain initially what it's about. Well, we'll have to deal with the amendment 166, however, as it's at this stage in the proceedings.
Okay, well, I'll speak to 166 and allow the committee to guide me if you want me to go through all the other consequential amendments. Amendment 166 is designed to make sure that a tenant who is exercising the right to buy and enforce sale doesn't lose that right to buy if the seller causes a delay. Under the bill at the moment, a tenant loses their right to buy if they don't pay for the land by the final settlement date. But the landlord might not be able to transfer the title for the land in time to meet that date, and that would mean the tenant wouldn't be able to pay for the land in time. On a potential reading of the current drafting of Section 38J, the tenant would then lose their right to buy through no fault of their own. So this amendment simply clarifies that the tenant doesn't lose the right to buy in these circumstances. This is also consistent with the provisions for the community right to buy in Part 5 of the bill as well. Go through the other minor amendments.
We should leave them just now, in fact. So do any other members wish to talk about this just now? Comments? No. Cabinet Secretary, to wind up, probably.
Well, in that case, I'll just formally move Amendment 166.
Yeah. Thank you. The question is, Amendment 166 be agreed to? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Sale when the landlord's in breach, restriction on the notice to quit, etc., where the sale is to a third party. Call Amendment 373 in the name of Rob Gibson. 273. In the name of Rob Gibson, in a group of its own, and I will move it now and speak to this amendment. This amendment seeks to protect a tenant from eviction after an enforced sale by restricting the new landlord's ability to issue him with an incontestable notice to quit. When a tenant successfully ordered the sale of his holding because the landlord was failing to meet his obligations under Part 10, Chapter 3, I want to avoid the new buyer being able to swiftly evict the tenant. The tenant should have a chance to bring the holding back to productivity now that the obstructive landlord has been removed, rather than the new landlord being able to take it out of production for the first 10 years. Given agricultural timescales, 10 years was chosen as a fair amount of time when I put this forward to give the tenant some protection from significant further change that could be damaging. The land court won't be able to grant a certificate of bad husbandry. The landlord won't be able to issue an incontestable notice to quit because he wants to put the land to non-agricultural uses. The landlord won't be able to issue an incontestable notice to quit that relates to permanent pasture. I wonder if other members wish to make any comments on those. Alec Ferguson.
I'd like to ask a question, which you may be able to clarify, Convener, because if I understand this correctly, and it's distinctly possible that I don't, it seems to me that this amendment could force the sale of the holding to a third party because the landlord had not complied with the lease, and then allow that third party to terminate the lease because the tenant had failed to comply with good husbandry which failure was a result of the original landlord's failure to comply with the lease in the first place. And I would really seek clarification on that, if possible, because I don't quite understand the rationale or justification. I don't quite understand the rationale or the justification of the provisions in the first place.
Okay. Any other member wish to contribute? No, if not, Cabinet Secretary to respond.
Thank you, Convener. I thank you for bringing forward this amendment, which we are happy to support. I welcome the protection this would give tenants after and before sale. It would help to make sure the tenant has the opportunity to farm the land to a high standard again, which the actions of the former landlord had been perhaps preventing the tenant from doing. We don't identify with Alec Ferguson's concerns.
My intention is to press this amendment because I don't think that Alec Ferguson's concerns are material in the sense of the protection of the tenant's rights here, and I believe that it will be useful for the tenant to be able to have this clarity through the amendment that I propose just now. The question is then that Amendment 273 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. The sale where the landlord's in breach, exclusions from clawback payment after early resale. Call Amendment 167, the name of Michael Russell, group with Amendment 167A. Call on Michael Russell to move his Amendment 167 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Clearly, it went unnoticed that I'd already introduced this amendment the last time I spoke because I was getting ahead of myself. So I'll just say again, I think it's a jolly good thing, and it will work particularly well for those tenants who are put in difficult positions by a landlord that's not fulfilling their obligations. No landlord should profit from his or her failure to fulfil their obligations.
I have moved it.
And I am moving it.
Thank you very much. Now call Claudia Beamish to move Amendment 167A and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you. I speak in support of Mike Russell's amendment, and it might seem like a quibble of language, and I have great respect for Mr. Russell and his linguistic abilities. However, I would like to see the word must rather than may put into the amendment, and I think I'll leave it at that.
So you're moving 167A.
Yes.
You are indeed. Okay. Any other member wish to comment on that? If not, Cabinet Secretary to respond.
Firstly, we're happy to support Michael Russell's amendment. The bill already provides that when a landlord is ordered to sell the holding because they've breached their obligations, the price a tenant pays to the land excludes the value of the tenant's improvements. It's only fair that the landlord shouldn't profit from improvements if the land is later resold either. The amendment would also let us make sure that the former landlord didn't profit from other factors that had increased the value of the land since the former landlord originally sold it, like diversification. So I support the policy behind Michael Russell's amendment, and for that reason we're happy to include provision and eventual regulations on that. We have some concerns over Claudia Beamish's amendment. While we very much appreciate what her amendment is trying to achieve, we don't believe it's appropriate because it would mean that the regulations would have to include every single type of improvement listed in Schedule 5 of the 1991 Act, whether it's relevant or not. Michael Russell's amendment will mean we have to work through the detail of which improvements are relevant to exclude from clawback, but Claudia Beamish's amendment forced us to include things before we'd even considered whether or not they were relevant. So I'd ask the committee to not support Claudia Beamish's amendment or for Claudia Beamish to reconsider whether she wants to press it.
Okay. In that case, Mike Russell to wind up.
I think I've said all I can possibly say about it. I will move it.
Thank you very much. And Claudia Beamish to wind up on Amendment 167A, press or withdraw?
I'll withdraw, thank you.
Withdraw. Claudia Beamish seeks to withdraw Amendment 167A with the agreement of the committee. Does any member object to that? No member has objected to that. So the question is that Amendment 167 be agreed to. Has moved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. The question is Section 81 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Right, I intend to finish consideration at this stage. which allows us a little more time for members to attend to their business, especially with this afternoon. And we will take up again next week at this point. We made some good progress today, I think, on some major points, and I'd like to thank you very much for your attention. At the next meeting of the committee, we'll consider several items of subordinate legislation before continuing with our consideration of Land Reform Scotland Bill Stage 2, Day 4. As agreed at the previous meeting, the committee will now move into private session to consider a draft correspondence to the Minister for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform on wildlife crime in the Scotland Annual Report 2014. I close the public part of the meeting and ask the public gallery to be cleared.